Okay, finally, it is this Red Leaf RetroCast Wrestling episode. On today's episode, with a lot of news, we got Marigold, which I brought on JPQ. And I had we had a fun little half-drunken conversation there, and it's going to kind of fly by. I quite enjoyed it. It was a lot of fun to do. Definitely a different perspective than what you're going to hear. And then following that, I will return solo to give kind of a lot of my thoughts after a week has gone by. So I'm recording this the morning before AEW Dynasty. And there's been a lot of discourse and falsehood of kind of what history is. And this is where I step in. And the on socials, there's been quite a lot of false narratives, and really it comes down to kind of a lot of tribalism and what kind of agendas and people being pissed off for one reason or another. And I guess it's my responsibility to at least set some sort of record straight and then give my own previews over the rest of the scene and what's happening right now. And I was going to do this about a week ago with the State of Joshi. And I guess I can kind of go through it on this episode, because that's what eventually is going to happen because of a lot of this. And then it's going to be myself and Ricky after the AJW finishing up All Japan Women Victory. With the Manami Toyota Aja Kong title match, Ricky and I are going to, we're in person. We pre-recorded our AEW New Japan Windy City Riots, a lot of those thoughts. And then we go into WCW, the Reset Show, a very famous WCW Nitro where Bischoff and Russo are back in charge, and the kickoff of the Millennium Club versus New Blood storyline, in which commentary is making just nonstop shoot wrestling comments, it's a work comments, the most insufferable commentary one could imagine. But was the show at least fun and interesting? Well, you know, did WCW blow through a year's storyline of Bischoff versus Russo just to kind of throw it away immediately? Well, yes, they did do that too. So, as Nellie Korda goes for her fifth straight LPGA title, as I've been locked in on that, I'm in full golf mode season myself. Bowling season's coming to an end. I only got a couple more weeks to throw my fifth straight month for a 300 game before summer break happens and I concentrate on another sport. WNBA is going to be very exciting here in a few weeks with Caitlin Clark and Angel Reese and company really coming into the league. Makes me want to do a women's fantasy basketball season. Women's sports, it's huge. And it's not just in that world. The wrestling world is going wild. So you will also hear during the Ricky and I that I will give my TJPW GCW live thoughts. That was not on the Patreon. On the Patreon is the Stardom and TJPW show Mania Weekend, along with the Ring of Honor Supercard of Honor live thoughts with Grizz. So if you want to listen to that, and head on over to the Patreon, patreon.com/redleaforretrocast. It's all there, along with the rest of the Mania Week experience. Lots of quick talking. Lots of late nights, drinking and fun. Hope you enjoy the rest of this episode.
Yeah.
And there we go. I had to play, like, so much of that because Marigold, the Hat Man, he's back.
Did he ever really leave?
Well,
you know, we've been kind of waiting for the announcement for, you know, that quick turnaround regardless. But my point is like, well, damn, when you talk about making a splash, the only thing brighter than this roster is with the suit that he wore when he announced it. My goodness.
So we're back from WrestleMania weekend. You had a great time at Mania. I know you did.
Sure did.
I did.
Oh, yeah, dude.
I had a fantastic time hanging out with everyone. And look, I could come on here and talk about the Sendai show from January that went up on the YouTube with the very good Sari, Chihiro Hashimoto, Miko Wada, Miyamoto match, 3 out of 3 rec. I could do that. I could also say the Sendai Korakuen was perfectly fine with a 1 2 out of 3 main event of Iwata and Venny. I could do that. Pretty good. Pretty good stuff. The Stardom build up towards Grand Queendom. Am I mixing up? What is it? No. Yeah, it's Grand Queendom. Grand Queendom.
Yeah.
Micah Momo Watanabe doing a 3 stages of hell match like it's Triple H in 2002. Or Aja Kong and Kaori Ito facing off against Melt here. What would be the comp there? Kevin Nash and Scott Hall coming back via NWO to WWF in early 2000s?
I mean, it works.
That's really what it feels like. Iwatani and Saori going at it. I don't know. Hanan, Wonder Title match. Rina and Saika Kurihara. Look, we got a Stardom card. I don't think Okada, Mr. Taro, has done particularly well building it up or announcing things when you got people like Shuri and Suzu Suzuki and whatnot kind of not having matches really announced at this point in time. But Kaorito's on the card. I don't know, man. I don't know.
We're taking it back.
But instead we have...
Why talk about all that, JD, when we can talk about a promotion that has your favorite and mine, Nane Takahashi.
Look.
Let's do Fuka, it. Let's just get into it, bro.
Fuka, the Hat Man, and Nanai are back for round 2.
Nanai, let's do it. Let's reset. Dude, let's go back to 2012. Let's just... 13 years ago is such a better time. Let's do it.
Joshi 2010's journey, patreon.com/redleafretrocast. There you go. Look, it's Vince Carter, 20 whatever years. He's got one more in him. Well, so do these three. They're the band's back together.
That's right. Tracy McGrady farewell tour. Let's do it.
Good God. Now Ishikawa, Nanai Takahashi, Mirai, for a little bit, Julia, Utami, Mai Sakurai, and Yuzuki, along with 6 actress girls, non-contracted talents, very distinguishable key detail there. Chiaki, Misa Matsui, Mika Ono, Natsumi Sumikawa, Koiki, and Chika Goto. This is like the Power 6 from Actress Girls, all coming over for, well, a real wrestling promotion.
Yeah. I mean, you can just say a wrestling promotion, right?
Yeah.
Because again, you can't contend that Actress Girls is pro wrestling.
Well, clearly not. They didn't even have them under contract. They could just leave whatever they want. They're a scummy little idol promotion. It's clockwork with them. It's clockwork with them. It's every 2 and 3 years that
it's pretty amazing.
Talents get ostracized or they leave, or it's always something. With AWG.
They just want to go wrestle. You know, it's really at the end of the day. I mean, whether it was the TAM Exodus or Saki and everybody with the reimagining of AWG and then now with present day the Exodus, it's just like it always seems to be the same thing, which is just like, we want to go wrestle. Well, you can't wrestle here. All right, well, then we're going to have to go somewhere else and wrestle.
Like, right.
It's just like, get these wrestlers who want to wrestle, and people want to see them wrestle. And the company's just like, no, we are not going to wrestle. And it was just like, okay, well, then we're going to go take our talents to South Beach. See you later.
We'll play for the Miami Heat. Let's no problem there. Pat Riley's on the call.
Yeah, Hat Man Riley. I mean, my goodness, Hair Man and Hat Man. Let's do it.
I've wanted something like this in the scene for years and years. It certainly needed this for years and years, especially with Ice Ribbon now a shell of its former self on death's door. Look, Ibuki Hoshi, pregnant, leaving the promotion for a long time. Tsukasa Fujimoto is making her debut in Seedling, not Ice Ribbon.
Nope.
And young talent Kaho Masashita, injured. She's out for basically the remainder of the year. So,
got nothing.
Oz Academy, not a real promotion either. They're a produce show, but still third in the scene.
Third in the scene.
Because they got the olds, they got the previous generation. That's how they book. That's what they do. Ozaki doing
you
this.
Think for a second that I wouldn't go. I would happily go spend money to go sit with all the grandmas, in the stands for an Oz show and just let them fawn over Ozaki. 100%, I'm going to that show. You're crazy.
Every person I've ever spoken to confirms that going to an Oz Academy show in person is great. It's a great time.
Yes.
So I have no reason to doubt that.
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely on my list. Like, I'm not going to go see TJPW when I'm in Japan, but you better believe I'm going to an Oz Academy show.
So Marigold, I think out of the gate, they're at minimum the now number three Joshi promotion.
they default to three in the lineup.
They're running Corken Hall May 20th, and then they're immediately touring, doing nine shows in the span of a month. Shinkiba First Ring, they're doing a double duty there. Very much Stardom's past. Osaka, Hamamatsu, another Corken on June 11th. They're going to Kyoto, Nagoya, Shinkiba, Sendai. This is exactly how Ogawa ran Stardom out of the gate the first time. And he's sticking with it. It's a tried and true formula. With the addition of the Actress Girls 6, it's like the SmackDown 6 over here. That's what I'm going to make a WWF reference there. There we go.
Just tying everything back to WrestleMania weekend.
Let's do it. It's on my mind. You know, I was there. I was having a good time. But yeah, we got Team Raw over here with Julia and Utami, right? And we got SmackDown 6 on the other end. Faction warfare. We got war games built already, man.
That's right. The Los Boricuas of AWG coming in.
Look, I'm not booking this like Russo. I'm not crazy.
I gotta tell you this. You know, it's funny. You look back in hindsight, right? And of course something like this was going to happen. You know, everybody was talking about a viable alternative and things like this. And people thought that Rossi and Bushiroad were all hunky-dory. And this dates back a little bit. But still, like, before all the, you know, all the... And everybody would sit there and say, well, like, hey, you could really make the case that Actress Girls is number three. I mean, I know people on the internet were, because they had, like, legitimate, like, good wrestlers that really needed to be showcased in better light. But they were stuck with Actress Girls for whatever reason. And so to see the scene change pretty dynamically, pretty quick, with Rossi leaving Bushiroad and then taking like the likes of an Utami and a Mirai and a Julia, Julia's head of the WWE, and Mai Sakurai and everybody else. And then just boom, we're going to take the whole main event scene, this, you know, Sinister Six, if you will, from... Actress Girls, and boom, we got a new promotion. We're gonna run. Like, you look back on it and you say, well, you know, Fuka was there and we kind of knew that was a thing, and we knew, like, I mean, there were times, JD, that we have talked over the years, specifically you and I, where we said, you know, Actress Girls really could be a viable third if they just kind of got their wrestling shit together. And now fast forward whatever, like 2.5 years since those conversations, and it's like, oh, well, they didn't, but you know what? Bushiroad didn't get their shit together, and Actress Girls didn't get their shit together, and so Rossi just looked at the scene and said, you know what? I'm going to take the best of both worlds and put them together, except for Saki Kashima, you know, which I think was actually was a surprise to me personally. I thought there was more loyalty there, but either way. But it, and then again, you know, that she got that fat check now because she's, you know, single champion. So, you know, I get that side of it too. In fact, she probably was leaving and they're like, you know what, we're going to let you go win this in Philly stateside. How does that make you feel? And she goes, oh, as long as I don't got to run. They're like, fine. So, so she probably bargained or negotiated herself a deal because she's a smart businesswoman like that. But outside of her, you really do take the best of both worlds. You put them together and you say, boom, we got a new promotion and we're going to go, you know, Rossi the shit out of this schedule. It makes a lot of sense. You know, as someone who's kind of been out of it, you know, watching from afar for a little while now, like I'm surprised that it happened to the level that it happened. But really, as the dust settles, this is the most attractive third promotion that could potentially be put together. You know, like a merger of Ice Ribbon and Seedling would have done nothing. Pure J doing anything with anybody else would have sucked. You know, Oz Academy doing I love Ozaki. But her doing anything with anybody ever is the worst idea unless you're an Ozaki fan. You know, we got crops to sow out in Sendai. Like, there's no real tangible, you know, direction that the Joshi scene could have gone without Rossi and AWG coming together in some form or fashion. And to do it without Bushiroad and AWG and just mwah, Fuka and Nane and or Nanai and Rossi coming back together and just poaching talent and things like that, just like the olden days. God, we should have seen it coming. We're fools. You know, we're sitting here talking about chess and Rossi's playing checkers. It's insanity.
I'm not even saying poaching. I can't. It's certainly
really a poach. You're right.
It's not poaching when you don't have wrestlers under contracts. They're free. They're free agents. He has cash to do it and give wrestlers steady pay. And even on his departure from Stardom, like, I understand why he was fired. That's fair enough. And he also wanted to leave too. You know, that's business. And if he's on his way out, he's gonna, you know, say a few words like, hey, I'm starting a thing. It's like, have you ever worked a recruiting job in your life or been recruited yourself? I mean, shit. Offers stand. And then you take the offer if it goes.
If the offer's still there, you just grab it.
Right. I mean, you look at the roster before the Actress Girls came in, and I'm like, okay, it'll take time to build. Maybe you get a Nagisa Nozaki in there. Maybe you get a Takase in there on a, you know, me being optimistic on that sense. You throw in the Actress Girls after Bushiroad seemingly has played PR defense throughout the whole time with getting Risa Sera and company, sending wrestlers to Wave and AEW. They're kind of locking Rossi out of certain options, and he's taken the other fork in the road, right? He's going, okay, I'm great with Kairi and Io Shirai still. I have the Actress Girls from this scene that's isolated themselves. I don't work with AEW, so he's taken the other half of the scene. This is competition breeding more competition, and I love it. I really do. Yeah. And then come yesterday, upon our recording here, and this is also why I wanted to record late, or on a later date, is Noah, on Monday Magic, because Marigold is announced to be on Wrestle Universe, which is easy access, so there's, and
English they're doing... English commentary.
Right, English commentary, they got subtitles and everything, things Bushiroad has been slacking on as of late.
Nap time.
Look, they immediately ran an angle on Takumi Aroha, Nagisa Nozaki, and Miyuki Takase. And they're running an 8-man tag at a Sumo Hall show. We're not pulling punches here. We're doing angles. We're doing things to gain interest in the promotions. This is basic tactic stuff, and it's working. It's got everyone talking about it, and I don't know if you've noticed on social media or whatnot, or some of the other Joshi podcasts out there. Look, there's already sections and sectors of Marigold podcasts immediately cropping up
Yeah, they
where's all those individual TJPW podcasts? They don't exist. That's what I'm saying.
Nah, TJPW ones don't really exist now. Shout out to Rabbit.
Oh yeah, he's years gone Crush at this Rabbit. Point.
Sure is.
Yeah.
To the point, and to the point, JD. You know, again, like it's exciting right now. Like, who knows? I mean, you might see some WCW-esque BS, like. At the Pure J Kurrican for the main event, you know, you just have, you know, right before the main event, Mai Sakurai, you know, walking up with Mirai and sitting front row, you know what I mean? Staring at Nakamori and, you know, it's all on the table at this point. You know, we don't know what to expect. We don't know what's going to get this buzz in. And Rossi's got a whole bunch of ideas. You know, shit, so that he's been sitting in a book that he wrote down in a book 20 years ago that he's been waiting for the right roster to unload on. So, you know, we got, you know, my hope is that we do get some fun out of this with them popping up at random things and doing different things. And a lot of it should be done on Wrestle Universe. So, you know, again, that $10 a month sub is looking a hell of a lot sweeter now than it was, you know, less than a week ago. It's crazy.
Yeah, I'm incredibly excited for this this new venture. It's what the scene has needed. And honestly, I still would like to see a consolidation because let's not pretend Seedling, hell, even our own podcast dedicated to Pure J. Pure J is kind of not on high marks either. They're kind of lower end of the scene. I'd like to see some of these companies consolidate and become one. And rather than just be rosters of four people sharing the same 10 to 15 freelancers over and over again. Marigold is very much needed in this scene, and it's gonna definitely spur a lot more excitement and interest and discussion. And I can't wait.
Yeah, me too. I mean, Rossi said it best the other day where he said, like, I'm not really concerned with what they do outside of wrestling. Like, it's 2024. So they want to do this, if they want to do that, they want to do this. I'm not stopping them from doing any of that stuff because they're going to do it anyway, and they have the platforms to do it. Where... again, a lot like, you know, what we kind of seen with the stagnation of some of these other promotions over the course, specifically since the pandemic or right before the pandemic. But I mean, you could date this thing back to 2017, if not, and you can go back further. But my point is that we've seen stagnation for a good amount of time now, like 5 years going for a lot of these different these independent promotions, because it's like I'm going to keep Oz Academy out of this, but like, okay, like, you know, Command Bolshoi has Pure J and the champion is Nakamori and Leon's going to be in the main event scene with her. And then if it's not her, it's going to be Higane. And then we're just going to kind of rotate the rest of them out. And they're going to be rookies for the next 5 years. And then maybe that'll pan out if they don't get married off or if they don't get pregnant or whatever the case is, yada, 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 yada. And I'm not going to move too far away from what I know because I may not be hitting home runs, but I do know I can get 100 people in the door if we just play it this way every year. And I can kind of build a budget around that and build a book around that. And we can just kind of make that what it is. And that'll just be what we are for the continuation of time. Rossi kind of threw the book out and said, okay, well, we're not going to worry about that. We're going to break some of these traditional, quote unquote, unwritten rules. And I'm going to go get this talent over here. I'm going to go bring these people in. And we're going to split from the thing that I created. And we're going to start our own new thing. Now you got to compete against that. What's your next move? Now they can stay 100 people at Itabashi Green Hall. You know, they can stay at the Ice Ribbon Dojo and continue working on building new wrestlers through Wrestling Circle or whatever the case is with Ice Ribbon. You know, yeah, you can do all that. But now that there's a new player in the game, that's just one more promotion that is vying for eyes that are no longer going to be paying attention to you. So, you know, as that competition increases, you would just assume that, you know, the demand for the promotions that aren't doing anything are going to begin to lessen because there's just one extra thing to watch. Maybe it does force their hand to begin to work together in a more cohesive manner than just trading talent and using freelancers, to your point.
Hey, short, concise thoughts. That's all we need. We'll be back, I guess, in a couple weeks. And by that time, we will have, I think, Noah in the books. We will have more information on Marigold, hopefully, and what actual contract statuses there will be. And I guess I'll be paying attention to how the freelancers will react to now Marigold clearly coming in and willing to sign people. Will Stardom react accordingly? Well, they already signed Konami back to a contract. She's back in the fold there.
Sure.
And Rossi's up to his old tricks of finding unnamed foreign talent and bringing them in about the names of Bozilla. There's I believe that's Alpha Female's daughter, if I'm not mistaken.
Cool.
Then actually I have the two other names here. Here we go. It is Myla Grace and Zeta Steel. So one's from the East Coast indie scene, which I'm familiar with, and then the other is from Ireland, which Alex from Stardom Quest, he's familiar with. So three promising talents there.
Question for you. In the next 3 months, name an indie freelance indie wrestler that finds their way to Marigold full-time.
Oh, specifically Marigold. Yes. A person from Australia that we've never heard of.
Okay, I was going to say stay domestic, but I'm fine with international. All right, so you're going to go... Oh, he needs Class A, bringing them. I'm going Saki, all caps.
Oh, okay. I thought you were sticking... I thought you were asking me about like a foreign talent specifically, but okay. Yeah, why not Saki? She wrestles literally everywhere.
I think she's going to sign. I think.
Oh, you think she's just going to straight up sign with Marigold?
I think she's straight up. I think she's going to be done on the independents. She's been booking herself. She's been doing great. I mean, again, I got a lot of positive things to say about her. She continues doing it. Awesome for her. But I think she pulls the trigger and she signs, and then she becomes a more formidable player within Marigold within the next 3 months.
Oh, within 3 months. Okay. I like that. That's a good bullish prediction. I think you'll be met with some confusion with that because there's the statement that was brought out that Yuzuki said via the Hatman's words is they're looking for young talent between the ages of 13 and 30, unmarried.
Is Saki married?
No. She is over 30.
Is she 30? Is she over 30?
But the to distinguish that is rookies.
Yeah, she's 36. Damn. She's my age.
Bro. Yeah.
Good for her.
Our age.
I like her more.
Dude, I like Saki.
Yeah, right. Me too. I thought she was like 29, 30. No. I mean, I knew she was on the cusp, but now
she looks 36. Great.
Well, yeah.
No, the key to that statement was rookies.
Yeah. Yeah, that was rookies, but, you know, what was her name? Maya Yukihi made that comment when somebody asked her about Stardom, and she made a joke about her being too old, you know, so because of that, yeah, it probably does rule out Asaki, for sure.
I don't think it would, because...
I don't know.
They essentially had that same rookie rule in Stardom, and they still got, like, Mai Sakurai and company.
True. I guess when they come out and say it, though, 13 to 30 unmarried, and I get that they're looking for more, like, if you want to get into wrestling, these are the requirements.
Yeah, I mean, it's the same as a soccer club going, we're not going to go and look out for a 32-year-old rookie. They're not going to do that.
That's true. I just don't want to look dumb on the internet. You know how this works.
I like your Saki pick. I'm going to stick with my unknown Australian that nobody knows about.
I like it. That's how Thekla started, but you know that she came from Austria.
Austria, not Australia.
Austria, right. Well, who was that one other one? Who was the Australian that came over for the Grand Prix?
You know what? I will throw out a definitive Australian name out there. Jessica Troy.
Oh, that's a good... is she Australian?
She's Australian, yeah.
The redhead, right?
I mean, she could dye her hair, whatever.
No, but I'm saying... you know what? I'm thinking somebody else.
Yeah.
Thinking somebody else. Gotcha. Yeah.
All right.
Yep.
I think we're done here. That's Marigold.
We're done.
Nice, quick 25 minutes over the new promotion and the last 2 weeks in Josie somehow. Thanks, JPQ. Crazy.
Always fun.
Later. The Marigold action is completed with JPQ. I am back solo. And boy, oh boy, what a week. What a crazy last 3 weeks. And the short version is the state of Joshi has been turned upside down. And what was normally going to be an annual, what's going on in the scene, what's happening here, things have been turned upside down for better and for worse. And for many, many years, been calling for kind of a consolidation of the scene, whether that's Pure J and Seedling come together to make one company, Diana, etc. What's happened is Marigold's existence. We finally have a big three again. Ice Ribbon, really falling through the cracks, has left a huge void as my cat, get down, come on, what are you doing? Don't go up there. He wants to go on a very high shelf, and that would only cause me problems. But so it was announced that Arisa Nakajima is retiring at the August Korakuen for Seedling. Seedling just ran Korakuen, got 700. And with Sari, Tsukasa Fujimoto, Arisa Nakajima all on the card. Look, retirement's draw. The prospect of kind of the very small amount of stars left on the scene outside of Stardom and now Marigold are few and far between. And whether that number is super legit or not, Seedling always tends to draw with their Korakuens to that, you know, whatever that number may be worth today. But with the retirement announcement of Arisa Nakajima, I can only assume it's based on the neck injury she suffered. It very much reminded me of what happened with Sting in the match in WWE that took him out. And look, nothing's hitting in the scene right now. And I really guarantee that if the scene was really popping off to what it was doing in about 2017, 2018, 2019, that Arisa Nakajima would probably be sticking through it. She'd find a way. She'd find a way to get her neck healthier again, and she'd be at it. But the reality is, the scene is not doing well. With this prospect of her retirement, I expect, and Alex said it on Twitter first, so credit to him. I have to give him so much credit. He's not an engagement farmer. Him and Dylan over at Stardom Quest do, in my opinion, outside of this podcast, of course, they do the best coverage on what's happening. I know they're Stardom focused and centric. That is their prospect. They just came out with the Gold episode talking about Marigold and Dreamstar Wrestling Marigold. And they're the ones that's covered. They're the ones that's really covering it to what it actually means, what's going to happen in the scene. And on Twitter, Alex said that the prospect of Arisa Nakajima's retirement is going to essentially be the official shutdown of Seed. It lines up with a 10-year anniversary in which sponsorship would end. Same thing happened with Gaia when the sponsorship contract went out. 10 years to the day, bang, Chigusa Nagayo shuts the company down. All signs point to that, and the retirement of Arisa Nakajima is step one. And yeah, the injury, I believe, truly believe, the injury and the combination of the health of the scene and I think the assumption of a sponsorship contract coming to the end, Seedling's going to be going away. And the reality is, Seedling hasn't been a company for a long time now. Well over a year, where they hardly run. A lot of their talent signed up with Tsukiban, whatever the fuck that means. I don't think those contracts are worth the paper they're written on. And there's no prospect of a third show even announced. And watch, you know, tomorrow that they announce a show in May in, like, L.A. or something. But regardless, Arisa Nakajima is retiring. Look, I'm going over her comeback right now on the Joshi 2010s journey over on the Patreon, patreon.com/redleafretrocast. You can recount her amazing career and what she's done with the Joshi scene. She's, I'm in the middle of her title run, or actually I've just started her title run when she's come back out of the injury / retirement that she had the first time. And I'm looking forward to traveling through her career again. And Tsukasa Fujimoto, I brought her up. You heard the music. Look, she's come back. She's had a kid, but she's not coming back to Ice Ribbon. She came back to Seedling, to her one of her good friends. And now we see why. And what does that mean for Tsukasa Fujimoto going forward? Look, I think retirement's going to be announced for her too. I think there's with Joshi Wrestling in its history, when wrestlers get married, have kids, they reach a certain point, injury, all these things factor into retirements and leaving the business in some capacity or another. And this is why every single company out there, and I'm going to reel back to this soon enough, is there's a reason why a lot of these companies, Diana, TJPW, Stardom, Marigold Now, the key recruiting factor is someone single, under 30, to recruit into their company. You know, those are the people that you want to recruit into your wrestling organization to try to at least be there longer term than just, oh, I had a kid, oh, I can only be here part-time kind of deal. I mean, places can do that. Look at Ice Ribbon. They have 40, 50-year-old rookies, but they're not drawing anything. A business isn't going to fly going by that. You can do that. Ice Ribbon was very was criticized by the industry itself, how it was using Wrestling Circle to recruit children, teenagers, and adults the like. And for Marigold to come out and just straight up say, look, this is who we're looking for. If we're going to train you from scratch, you got to meet this criteria. Simple as that. And it is within their right. The not married thing, you know, my opinion is you don't really need that part. It is 2024, but this is also Japan. This is their culture. Should it change into something more progressive? Yeah, probably, but it's not my place to really go into cultural differences and throwing my own ideals onto something like that. I personally would probably get rid of the whole married thing. Now, the single and under 30 part, 13, look, these companies, they wanna try to get anybody and everything, and lowering the age is not new in the Joshi scene. That ideal has not changed since the fucking 60s, okay? That's the reality of it, and the way I look at it is very much similar to sports, where soccer teams look at kids 11, 12 years old, try to recruit them into their development system early, so then when by the time they turn 16, 17, 18, hell, they could be a pro-level player for the club right out of the gate. I don't really see wrestling that differently. I think a lot of people, especially with a lot of the discourse online that's come in the last week, sure like to put out a lot of assumptions and really some hateful allegations out there for whatever company that they hate this week. And Rossy Ogawa has, I guess I'm talking about it now, Rossy Ogawa has always been kind of a focal point of that because he's a man running a business, and he certainly has a history of shady, cutthroat business tactics. Before I go on to that, I want to say Ibuki Hoshi has announced a pregnancy, and she will be leaving Ice Ribbon for the foreseeable future to have a kid. Beautiful story, but again, Ice Ribbon can't catch a break. Kaiho Matsushita, I think, her tore ACL. She'll be out 9 months. This company is a shell of itself. So now that leaves us with TJPW, Stardom, and now Marigold right out of the gate. Oz Academy is immediately number four. Marigold's Korakuen is really redefining what a sold-out Korakuen is now. The 1,400 tickets plus now opening up standing room and more things shows that, look, it's exciting. I don't think it was a slam dunk to really sell out immediately, but the amount of press and PR hit pieces from Stardom and Marigold the like are out there. So back to the Rossy Ogawa comments, where people have him labeled as a pedophile because of a variety of different business tactics, whether that's the annual photo books he's done with Stardom, and the total and complete baseless allegations against him really reminds me a lot of the Chris Jericho comments. Maybe not into the same vein, but look, this man has been around since the 60s in the business, and you would think, much like in a Vince McMahon case, if there was some truth and basis to it, that there would be cases going back decades, and there simply hasn't in those types of allegations. Is he a cutthroat, shady businessman? Absolutely. If we look at how he started Arsian to how he started Marigold, it's very much along the lines of the same beat, right? This is the stuff we have real history for, where he gets Kandi Okatsu out of retirement from JWP. He straight up says when he's launching Arsian that he's poaching talent. He straight up said that, where he's going to take XYZ from LLPW, XYZ from JWP, and oh yeah, he's also going to take other wrestlers that... And at the time in 97, 98, a lot of those contracts were coming due or they were not being paid. So to quote-unquote take wrestlers that were not being treated well in their own company and really give them a kickstart in his own, that really matches up with what we're seeing with Marigold here, with the Actress Girls 6 that had no contracts to speak of, were not being treated well in that company. He just kind of went, if you guys want to come, so be it. And maybe in his, after 20 years of doing that, he's choosing his words carefully. And with the Komomo rookie out of Stardom that got injured and then never re-debuted, well, here she is showing up in Marigold. Kind of reminds me of some other tactics in how he started Arsian. Now, is the selling tactics and recruitment any different than any other company out there? No, it's not. Diana and TJPW debuted young teenagers, and they do photo books too. Just last year, TJPW has their wrestlers doing photo books on their roster right now. Look at Wakana. You go on her Instagram, she's doing gravure shoots currently. You know, and she's referencing things that she did for the business 4 years ago, or for her own business, as I drink some coffee here. Ooh. Is the state of the Joshi wrestling business broken? Yes, I've been saying that for years and years and years. How do they make money? How do they sell tickets? How do they do anything? You kind of got to, sometimes you got to swallow some pride and do things you're not proud of. Right? Or maybe they are proud of them. They like doing what they do, from what I can tell. Whether it's Unagi doing gravure shoots on the side, Maya Yukihi's done them, Actress Girls leaving their company overnight to go to a company that they see a future in. So to throw out things like pedophilia, and to hear Kenny Omega on a stream, I don't know what has happened with that guy. I'm very disappointed with baseless comments that he made and the whole I may know a thing or two, but he won't come out and say it. That's kind of disgusting and gross in its own way. If you have something, then say it. Because other than it really just goes further into tribalistic mentality. And that's what we've seen with WWE AEW now coming into the Joshi sphere, where Pro AEW is with Stardom, Pro WWE is with Marigold. What does Marigold with WWE mean? Well, it just means that people are now going to attack him and attack the promotion and its wrestlers. And far be me from me, Kenny Omega, but look, Riho and company went over to Stardom, and if you know something, you're throwing your friend into a dangerous situation, that's irresponsible on your half, too. Like, Kenny Omega's going to listen to this, but this is the stuff we're talking about. It's very selective reasonings and selective memories and selective tribalistic attitudes heading towards one promotion to another. We've seen it with Stardom versus TJPW. We're going to see it with Stardom and Marigold. We're seeing it with AEW, WWE. And it gets very tiring very fast. So I hope those that are clearly, look, those frequent listeners of Red Leaf Retrocast, you guys know the score and know the game and you know the history. And we all got to kind of line things up and keep them fresh in our heads. And I've seen some things thrown around about Asuka's manifesto again, where there's two sides of this thing. And I've told it on Red Leaf Retrocast Patreon when Neo and Passion Red with the Asuka and Nanai breakup being as shoot fighty as it happened, that had nothing to do with Ross Yogawa. That has everything to do with Nanai and Asuka. And Nanai and Shida also don't get along. Shida and Ross Yogawa don't get along. Aja Kong doesn't get along with Ross Yogawa because he sued her and she countersued him because of the false advertisement ring that was happening in Arsion. These aren't the allegations that you see on social media that line up. They just see a bunch of names thrown on and they go, well, there's a reason why Manami Toyota and Ross Yogawa don't get along. Okay, what does that have to do with what we're seeing put out online? Manami Toyota maybe just didn't get along with him, and that's why she never left AJW to go to any of these other companies, right? She went to Ice Ribbon, Shida, Tsukasa Fujimoto. You know, the groups of people all line up within each other, and now we have a scenario here where Ogawa's running his own company. He has no problem, clearly, with working with WWE and wanting his wrestlers to succeed as much as possible. He sees a brighter future with WWE. And hell, look at it. Io Shirai, Kairi, they're both there. He was their products. And I don't think their careers are as blissful as some others. But look, they're making very successful careers at WWE. Whether I like the wrestling that they're doing and the booking there is irrelevant to the conversation we're having now as I record this. So it's very disappointing to see a lot of this, and I'll circle back to the Asuka manifesto, where the short version is she had an issue with the old guard at the time. Let's throw Yumiko Hota out there. She's a prime candidate for this. And there's an A to Z background there, too, where Asuka Kana believed that the scene was being held back by mentalities and structures and cultures of the past. And it was and she was absolutely right. But was it also a play to spice up her own Gravure DVD that she released not so long later? Yes, both those things can be true, okay? And my research, it may not be 1,000% correct because I am not an insider, I'm not in the business. The information that I have that I believe to be at least true, is this is how it goes down. Ross Yogawa starts Arsion. He picks and pillages companies that weren't doing well at the time. JWP was fucking closing, okay? LOPW was essentially gone by 97, okay? They didn't have much going on either, okay? Ogawa goes through some rough periods with Arsion over the couple years, false advertises Aja, because Aja wanted out. Things weren't going well there. He sues. She countersues. He goes broke. And he has stated this himself in his own book and on his own accounts that he was living out of his car. That's how broke he was. He sells the company to Yumiko Hota. A to Z starts. This is where Asuka, Ayumi Kurihara, this crew comes in. Okay? So there's your connection there with Kana, Yumiko Hota, and how. And Ross Yogawa was gone. He was essentially gone from the scene. He did consulting here and there, namely with JD Starr. He did not own, he did not book that company. That was a Jaguar Yokota start. She sold it. And there's a good chunk of how JD Starr with the ActRest program started. You see a connection there as well. And they went their ways there. Jaguar Yokota was the consultant. was not Rossi Ogawa. These are the this is the information that I have, that I firmly believe this. And it wasn't until Fuka rolled around, JD Star again, and she was retiring, Rossi Ogawa hooks up with her, saying, "You're too good, let's start a company." Nanai's promotion, Chick Sun, was folding because AJW had folded. She was not doing well. The three of them come together, they start up Stardom, and they go business mode out of the gate. What sells? Well, hot young women sell. Yuzapon comes in. And the rest is history from there. Okay? Hell, I'm watching just on the Joshi 2010s now. There is the second anniversary show. Guess who's on those cards? Tsukasa Fujimoto. Hikaru Shida went on the card a year prior with the Bull Nakano retirement. There wasn't bad blood from the start, okay? Bad blood later for whatever reason, whether that's trying to get wrestlers from other promotions, the Risa Sera situation comes in. And yes, there are certain people that won't work with others. There's bad blood with like Diana and Marvelous and Marvelous and Wave at periods of time. And yet, you know, I have my reservations about Kyoko as a businesswoman, a booker, a trainer. But her mentality, along with Ogawa's in training wrestlers, is not that different. It really isn't. You can see it as it plays out. So that's where we're at. And the state of the scene is that, where there's a lot of companies now, Pure J, Wave, they're floating above the water, but they're sinking halfway through, and they're waiting for a rock to be thrown on them. Because Yuki Miyazaki, among other things, is not holding a company up, and they're not growing, okay? I like Pure J, and we're going to see what they do at the Cork and Hall, full Pure J podcast out there, and with Akari in the main event against Hanako Nakamori, who also has a connection with Arisa Nakajima. See, everything comes full circle. Time is a flat circle, okay? We're going to see how these companies do for the remainder of the year, and then we have Oz Academy, looking like they're going to end their Marvelous partnership, because guess what? Marvelous is probably going to work with Marigold. And companies are going to pick and choose who they work for to whoever they think can give them the best advantage. I don't think this Oz Academy thing is doing gangbusters for Marvelous. It's doing something for Oz Academy, but it's not doing something for them. We see that Risa Sera's group has continued to pick Stardom based on the Crazy Star match and Suzu Suzuki and all that. TJPW has their working relationship with the likes of Ryu Mizunami, Aja Kong coming in. And speaking of Aja Kong, it's funny how the phone was picked up immediately upon the departure of Rossi Ogawa, and now we immediately get hit with Aja Kong and Kairo Ito and the old guard doing kind of the Grifter 101 move, is get me in a match with your most popular wrestlers or rookies, right? Get me the payday. The next month, and then 3 months, and then 6 months, as we head into 2025, we're going to see the scene continue to change. We're going to continue to see tribalistic and baseless comments be thrown around to try to defile. Well, yeah, you'll use that. We'll use that term to try to infect the minds of people so they can pick sides. I have my opinions over wrestlers and how they operate. But far be it from me to call out people in what they do and what they are. Maybe I didn't word that correctly. I'm still thinking about it as I had said it. And hopefully, I hope I laid something out that makes sense. And if you're a new listener, I hope you learned something. Time for AJW. Okay. Okay, fourth time's the charm to try to get this episode out. AJW Destiny, here we are. It's definitely recording. I can look at it. OBS, you will not freeze up on me again. Holy shit. Okay, yes, we are continuing. I'm continuing. Part two of Wrestling Queen of Victory, March 26th, 1995, Yokohama Arena. Okay. The short version, because I'm just so tired of trying to repeat myself for this recording to work. I know nobody cares, but this is going to go down as one of the most frustrating episodes I've attempted to do. So here we are. The short version is, I have taken articles from Weekly Pro, read a couple Shoe Pro articles, read some boards, and I have the Wrestling Observer newsletter, April 10th, 1995 here. And with the exception of some of Dave Meltzer's comments within the matches and what Weekly Pro was able to coordinate with or corroborate with the stats put out from the Observer, it all matches up. And I will end this with the overall standing of what Aja Kong's Red Belt reign was. Because there was some interesting opinions, even at the time, of how good the reign was. And yes, this is the Manami Toyota Aja Kong match of Manami Toyota winning the Red Belt, the 3AW title. And what I was able to also, based on what I read, is kind of come to the conclusion that there was a booking committee in 1995, and this show was kind of the prime example of what I'm able to interpret from this era. So as we know, or as we assume, and from various other sources, whether it's Fumi and Meltzer and Weekly Pro, that the interpromotional warfare and the, we'll call it, political cooperation was through Rossi Ogawa. He was the one that was talking with JWP, LOPW, FMW, Onita, and he was the broker between getting the matches set, the wrestlers set, and the overall booking of those shows, while the one of the members of the Matsunaga family, not the main two, but we'll call him the third brother or whatever, is due to circumstances and leaving the interpromotional warfare behind, that he was the one that kind of took over some key booking aspects in 95. And I think this show was the kind of combination of the two, where he had his ideas of what the main events were going to be, and the rest of the card, especially with wrestlers from outside the company, Ogawa was in charge of that. That's my interpretation of the information I was able to find and discern. So, for example, we got Kandi Okatsu in the undercard, JWP. Hey, things come full circle with Arcian many years later, where Okatsu comes out of retirement and joins up with Ogawa. Okay, this part makes sense. You had the CMLL match. Jagger Yokota, Lady Apache, Yoshida, Diabolica, CMLL, Rossi Ogawa again. And I could even find some some cooperation with the LCO match in the undercard with the UWA tag titles, Tomoko Watanabe, Suzuki Minami. These matches, I believe, were firmly in the Rossi Ogawa playbook. Saki Asagawa by Sakamura, same thing. Now, what were the matches? Oh, and Bull Nakano and Kyoko Inoue, I believe, was a Rossi Ogawa thing. What were the Matsunaga? What was the Matsunaga brother firmly behind? The UFC matches. The Yumika Hota Asuka UFC type match, and the ultimate decision of the main event of Manami Toyota defeating Aja Kong. Aja Kong was very much a product of Rossi Ogawa, and this is my belief, from what I've read, that Aja Kong's push was based off of Ogawa, while then he had to broker a lot of the other aspects of the interpromotional war, and the Matsunagas got a little more hands-off. And now we've reached a point where LOPW is out of the picture, Onita and his FMW cronies are out of the picture, because, well, LOPW decided to go into business for themselves at the Dome, a.k.a. Shinobu Kandori. And then Onita just wanted to stop seeing his wrestlers lose. He wanted to get them to be booked on the same level as AJW, and that wasn't going to happen. Like, get out of here. So, the Matsunagas got sick and tired of this shit. And ultimately came to the conclusion, we're entering a new era, 1995. We're going to step back from that. We're still going to work with JWP because they're willing to play ball. Ogawa, you go handle that. And because the Aja Kong third from the top deal were kind of done and over with the interpromotional matches, whether it's Kong, Eagle Sawai, Kong, Kansai involved, you get the idea there. I think it's time, this is Matsunaga's talking, I think it's time to take the title off Kong, and we're going to get this thing on Manami Toyota. We think she's going to be the next thing, and we're going to try to get Akira Hokuto back into this company as much as possible. We're going to keep her from retiring and work on a part-time schedule. So I am calling this by committee booking, and you still see a good chunk of this, I believe, is off the hands of Rossi Ogawa, and the Matsunagas are kind of taking main booking power to the things that they think can make them the most money, because also they're not selling as highly as they were in years past. They're not selling out Yokohama Arena anymore, 14 plus thousand people. They're getting 8,500 at Osaka Castle. They're getting 9,000 at this victory show here, which I think are good numbers even for the time. But compared to like New Japan and All Japan selling out Budokan and that aspect, they're more on competing with the sections of war and among those promotions. They're wiping the floor with LOPW and JWP still, so they're still in the women's realm, number one. It's not close, but you get the idea there. So, going to the Wrestling Observer, April 10th, 1995. Manami Toyota ended the two-plus year reign of Aja Kong as the 3WA Women's Champion in the main event of March 26th, Yokohama Arena Show. Remember in part one, I went over kind of the first half of the card, the young talent getting a lot of shine, and again, I think a lot of that has to do with Rossi Ogawa. I divulge back into the Observer, Dave Meltzer writes, the show was an experiment by the company to see what their drawing potential is on their own. From the heyday of the Crush Gals through 1993, and it goes on and on. All Japan had its biggest show of the year, 4,900-seat Yokohama Buka Gym, by opening up relations with other offices, JWP, etc., etc. However, there are inherent problems with working with organizations that want their people to win as much as they lose when the caliber of wrestlers is nowhere near the closest to the same level. This group disappointed with a crowd of about 9,000, and the crowd heat, while strong at the end of the show, was weak overall considering the quality of work. The crowd had to have been hurt by war running a big show at Sumo Hall, which drew 7,500 head-to-head, since many of the hardcore fans that attend women big shows only went to the Sumo Hall show. I'm not sure that the audience crossover is quite like that, but Meltzer writes, the cash registers at the souvenir stand were ringing with the caps. That must have been astounding, as while I was there, it seemed every fan was buying something, spending $80 and up, topping $200 in souvenir purchases. From start to finish, this show was even better than the Tokyo Dome of 1 week later because it didn't have any weak matches. I'm not sure what he like was referencing there, the AJW Tokyo Dome show or the Dome show in which there were the multiple women's matches. Ritamata pinned Kumiko Maekawa, 10:37 with spinning crossbody block. Work was good, but very little crowd reaction. 2-1/4 from Meltzer. Can't say I disagree much there. Chaprita Asari won the Japanese junior title from Kandi Okotsu of JWP, 15:33. They were doing near falls from the start, and then won several minutes of trading submissions. Asari, who was really tiny, has a few unbelievable moves, but isn't that good of a worker overall, whereas Okotsu, who is only 19, is the best young wrestler in any of the companies. Okotsu got shaken up as legit as she came off the top rope, and Asari was supposed to get her knees up, but got her feet up instead. Okotsu kept going, even did a plancha, but you could see the wind was knocked out of her, and it hurt during the climax of the match. Asari was supposed to do a twisting plancha off the top rope, but lost her balance, recovered, and did a Hokuto flip plancha instead. Asari won with her twisting moonsault, which is probably the hottest acrobatic move in the business right now. Solid little 3-star match. Can't say I disagree there either. I am not going to recount this horrible Sonata shootboxing draw with Kairo Ito. I will skip that. Jagger Yokota, Lady Apache beat Marika Yoshida and La Diabolica, now known as Flalina, in a Lucha Libre rules tag team match in 17 minutes, 58 seconds. Yokota and Yoshida were great, I agree, but the Mexican war women worked too slow and Flalina missed a lot of her spots. Fact. It wound up with Apache pinning Flalina, and immediately Yoshida pinned Apache, leaving the two Japanese in against each other. Two Japanese women, Meltzer, come on, add that in there. They went about 2 minutes with great near falls and a lot of heat before Yokota won with cross-arm German suplex, 2 3/4 stars. Oof, brutal. Yeah, I can't say I totally disagree. Etsuko Mita and Mima Shimoda retained the UWA tag titles, beating Tomoko Watanabe and Suzuki Minami in 19 minutes, 1 second. See how long these matches are? When Mita pinned Minami after a DVD, excellent match with tons of near falls. After the match, Suzuki Minami announced she would be retiring soon. 4 1/4 stars. So, yeah, I was kind of curious myself if Suzuki Minami announced her retirement on this show and if she gave a date. She did not give a date. It's just going to be sometime in the future. So we're here for Suzuki Minami. She's part of that Akira Hokuto type generation, and they're fading out. Whether that's the schedule and the amount of bumps and grime and battered and bruised that their body is at this time, I think that has a lot to do with it. And they, you know, I'm also believing that maybe she was kind of told it was about time for a retire. You're not a star. We're not going to push you. We have young talent on the rise coming on up. We need the roster space. It wouldn't shock me. Saki Asagawa pinned Bison Kimura with a rolling savate kick in 10 minutes, 5 seconds. Bison laid the chops in early, as she does. They brawled in the stands, and at one point, Kimura burying Hasegawa under chairs. Hasegawa missed a planche off the top rope, crashing onto the floor. I like how he put in parentheses, plan spot, like it was a shoot. Hasegawa did 3 Uranagi suplexes for near falls, while Kimura went back to doing her chops for near falls before Hasegawa hit the perfect kick and got the pin. 3.5 stars. Yeah, he liked that too. Okay, so now we're in the business end of the card. And here we go. The triangle match between Takako Inoue, Reggie Bennett, and Toshimada for the vacant All-Pacific title. The white belt was given up due to, a variety of reasons at this point in time, but here we are. And you may have seen this match with, the Catch the Wave finals for a great number of years back now, or even some seedling matches tend to do this every now and again. I think they do it with a high speed sometimes, but it hasn't been done in quite a few years. And this was hot. The total time on this match was, 20 minutes, 48 seconds in total. And as I go through what Meltzer's going to write here, you're going to see how, quick these falls came. And, seeing the total timestamps doesn't do it justice, because the match was quick, it was fast-paced, and I thought it was extremely effective. Now, because it was kind of new at the time, it's certainly a new concept, and I liked what they did here. I liked how they got to each place, and let me just read what was written here. Toshi Yamada won the triangle match from Takako Inoue and Reggie Bennett to win the vacant All-Pacific title. Rules were that the first person to pin both of her opponents would win the title. Bennett lost the coin flip. Okay, stop. So that means when she gets in the match, she has to win 2 straight falls. That's how that works. So Inoue faced Yamada first. Inoue pinned Yamada first in 9 minutes, 15 seconds with a flying knee to the back of the head. Very much jumping bomb angel style. Bennett then came in doing 1 power move after another and made Inoue submit to the Reggie rack in 2 minutes, 9 seconds. Lex Luger, eat your heart out. This rocked. Bennett faced Yamada, which had great heat ending with when Reggie put her in the Reggie rack, but Yamada elbowed her way out and scored a cradle in 4 minutes, 1 seconds. So now, this put Yamada versus Inoue with the winner getting the title. So Reggie, you out, girl. Kept her strong with the roll-up. The heat was awesome here. Inoue got an Achilles tendon hold. Not an ankle lock. It's an Achilles tendon hold in on the aisle and held it for several minutes. Awesome selling by Yamato. Yamato made a comeback and used the Gory Especial. Got to say it in Spanish, Meltzer. Good job. But Inoue reversed it back into the Achilles heel hold. But Yamato made the ropes. Finally, Yamato hit the JOCS, the Japanese Ocean Cyclone Suplex, in 5 minutes, 18 seconds to win the match and the title. 4.5 stars. Okay, I'm not that high. Let's calm down. I'm at like 3.75 here. But, you know, Yamato wins her first big singles title using Minami Toyota's move. Okay. I like this. This was a good spot for Yamato to win a title. Gives Takako Inoue something to go for in the future. Keeps everyone strong. And Yamada is finally getting a little push here. Singles, it's taken years for her to get to this level. I'm quite excited to see what's going to go on there. Okay. Yumiko Hota knocked out Lioness Asuka in 22 minutes, 53 seconds in what was billed as an Ultimate Fight Rules match. This was the stiffest and most brutal women's match I've ever seen, although it was clearly a work. Yeah, no shit, Meltzer, come on. They both did spots right out of the UFC shows, since the tapes are so big, and everyone registered, such as doing takedowns and throwing the punches straight down. Sure. The only difference was when they hooked the submissions. There were no rope breaks, but they could get a break by tumbling to the floor. They did a lot of submissions and falling to the floor. Hota wound up with a fat lip and a bloody nose. Asuka was bandaged up in the face after the match as well. They did several 9-count knockdowns with them struggling to beat the count before. Hota unloaded with a kick to the jaw for the knockout. 4.75 stars. This was insane. That's insane. As in the star ratings. Look, it's a product of the time. You had to be there. I'm fully in a belief of that. Do I think this is as good or nearly as good as, say, the stiffest and most brutal match I've ever seen in terms of women's wrestling, which is, both Kandori Hokuto matches? I think those are pretty high. Is it as stiff and brutal as, say, the Chigusa Nagayo Devil Masami match that went to the big draw and restart? I don't think it's anywhere in the ballpark of those matches. I thought this match was mostly boring as shit. Those submissions I thought would never end. And yeah, they did a few punches to shoot knock them in the face and bust themselves up hard way. Yes, that did happen, and that was gnarly. But mostly it was about putting Achilles heeled holds on each other and then tumbling to the floor. And then it was like last woman standing, 1, 2. I'm like, I'm not into this. I thought it was boring as hell. I'm going like 3 stars. I do not like these matches. Bull Nakano retained the WWF Women's title, pinning Kyoko Inoue in 17:07. Yet another awesome match. I couldn't believe the difference in Nakano, as she was so stiff, and in WWF she worked so light it was almost embarrassing. Nakano's first clothesline was like a Kawada shotgun lariat that set the tone for the old Bull Nakano being back, as opposed to Nakano who worked the Tokyo Dome. She even did a great tope. I don't know, she kind of missed it, but all kinds of great stuff from start to finish before Nakano used a somersault leg drop off the top rope for the pin. 4.5 stars. Look, I thought this match was awesome. I thought Kyoko Inoue really brought a lot of frenetic pace to her. She worked very fast, and each time she started to gain a little momentum, Bull Nakano would fucking kill this woman's throat. Just shoot her down real hard. This was the equivalent of a top-end Bull Nakano red belt reign title match. I adored this match. I thought it was great. I'm right there too. 4.5. This was my match of the night, believe it or not. And before the main event, so here we go, Hokuto was brought out for an interview. And to go along with Bull Nakano in the ring, came back out and said something to the effect of Hokuto should quit talking about retirement. Hey, we got part-time matches to do because they think no one else can draw the level they did. Well, I mean, sort of right. Hokuto at the Tokyo Dome at the end said she wasn't sure she'd come back to wrestling in Japan, and Nakano said they could both pretend to be something they aren't, but deep down they are both pro wrestlers. Yes, Bull Nakano sticking with that line. Nakano said she considered retiring as well, but realized she is a wrestler, and then cut a promo on Hokuto for their match in North Korea. Yes, gotta plug North Korea there here on Victory. Look, Collision in Korea is right there, and that brings up interesting comments between Bull Nakano's WWF time and Hokuto's WCW time that's ahead, and how they're both going to wrestle for WCW in North Korea. And we get to our main event. Manami Toyota pinned Aja Kong in 23 minutes, 21 seconds to win the 3WA title. This wasn't as good as their dome match because it was the total story with Kong reversing every move Toyota tried on her. Yes, this was a counter match from Aja Kong. I agree it wasn't as good as their dome match for sure. In fact, they've had better matches in the past. They're going to have better matches. Yet, this was still really good. I was not expecting Aja Kong to come in here and be counter wrestler. So Kong took the entire first half of the match, reversing every Toyota spot. Toyota made a few short-lived comebacks. Toyota did a dropkick off the top rope to the floor. Crazy. She then set up Kong on the table and went for a top rope splash. She then set up Kong on the table and went to the top rope to splash her off the top rope through the table on the floor, but Kong got her knees up. Whoa. Okay, sentences. Kong then powerbombed Toyota through the table. Nope, that's not true. She did a pile driver through her right on top. Julia style. Kong dominated again until she came off the top rope, and Toyota got her feet up shotgun style. At this point, they traded big moves, including Toyota doing a reverse Franken Toyota for a near fall. Okay. The match had huge heat, by far the best of the show. I don't know about that. Meltzer, you gave 4 3/4 to the fucking shoot match with the Hota and... All right, whatever. Toyota finally won with the Ocean Cyclone Suplex off the top rope. Okay, that's what they were trying to go for. They fucked up the first time, went back up, and she mostly did, like, kind of a tiger suplex off the top, sort of, after the match. So yes, Toyota pinned her with a gnarly little top rope move that didn't really look all that great, but after the match, Toyota issued a challenge to Akira Hokuto, saying that even though she holds the world title, that she has to beat Hokuto to be considered a real world champion. Yes, the old Ric Flair line. Hokuto grabbed the mic after the challenge, and weirdly enough, didn't give an answer. She's still, like, part-time, thinking about retirement, not sure what she's going to do next. Kind of a weird way to build up a future Toyota-Hokuto match and really seem like Toyota's not a real champion because Akira Hokuto still exists. I don't know if that's the best thing to do right out of the gate and to give a non-answer, but here we are. Meltzer went 4.5 stars on this. I'm like 4.25. You know, not too far off, but still, nonetheless, 4 stars? Very enjoyable. And I got to say, that Bull Nakano Inoue match, I think, was my match of the night. And yes, okay, so the reign of Aja Kong has ended. Manami Toyota has begun. The changing of the guard, if you will, is in full effect. The booking committee is in effect. And look, Aja Kong's red belt reign needs to be looked in a perspective of wrong time. You know, her first reign came off the heels of the great told story of Kong versus Nakano, and then they went straight into interpromotional warfare where Kong was third from the top most nights, right? She was not the main draw, the main piece of the puzzle. She was just kind of there, ready to hold the title and go against Hota and Eagle Sawai and Kansai. Wasn't there to put on the big marquee matches. That was Akira Hokuto. And then Toyota doing wacky shit in tags. Ozaki coming in and company. Those were the matches. And I'll say, her first year with the title wasn't like... It wasn't blowing my socks off, but it wasn't until the Hota hand match where I was like, okay, we got a champion. Let's do more of these. And then they just didn't do enough of them. You know, they decided to run back the Hota match and it wasn't as good. They told this story with Toyota building up to it and ultimately losing the title to her in this good match. But, you know, we had some failures in there. You know, we had the dome situation, but that was the dome. It wasn't about Aja Kong and the title. It was about other stories being told. And ultimately, that ended with Kong and Hokuto kind of not really delivering. Very much a lot of reasons behind that. But, you know, I'm going to be looking at this Toyota Reign to see what they do with her. And they immediately pinned her against Hokuto, right? That's a big deal. And I'm going to be looking at Kong's second reign with a different set of eyes, knowing that, you know, while this, I can't say this reign was a failure, but is it as revered as it kind of is stated? I don't know. I'm not there. I think it was a good reign. I mean, she held it for 2 years, and not like she threw out stinkers left and right. But, you know, I point to the Hota match as being the good match from a 2 year reign, and that's kind of it for me. I was not a fan of kind of the big girl matches that she ended up having with a lot of the wrestlers. I think she'll mature more over the next year, and we'll get a better reign next time, is what I'm saying. So that was Queendom Victory from Yokohama Arena, March 26, 1995. I hope you enjoyed the podcast. Ricky, you're dying.
You were dancing.
I always do that with the intro music.
Yeah, but it's different in person. Oh, yeah, we're in person, by the way.
Yeah. You're in Rhode Island. Hooray. Cheers.
We're all on the road to Rhode Island. Yeah, it's good. Yeah, so life stuff happened, and I ended up in New England this week. And it happened to be the week that we would normally record anyway, so here I am.
It worked out. Yeah. So we got AEW, WrestleMania week.
Woof, got a lot.
New Japan. Strong cocktails and beer.
Oof, this is tasty. I like it.
You like it?
Cheers.
Cheers. Just a cheap, simple-ass, normal beer.
That is just a delicious Pilsner.
Nothing fancy about it. And then we had a cocktail called an Old Pal.
Yeah, it's that from was like intense.
From the 40s, so it's hard and bitter, like my personality.
I was going to say just like you.
Yeah. For those wondering, it's Campari, dry vermouth, and whiskey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was something.
I definitely would not put it as good as a Negroni.
No. It's not very
It's very similar, though.
It's not as well balanced as the Negroni.
No, it's not. The lemon certainly helped a little bit.
Yeah. It's just not a well balanced cocktail. No. It was tasty, but
I'm wondering other stuff. I'm wondering if better. I make it like a Negroni, that would completely
maybe
change it. But that's how I made it, like how it was supposed to. So, where do we begin? WrestleMania week?
Yeah. You were in Philly. Tell me about it.
I was in Philly, met a bunch of people from the podcast, hung out with my man Grizz. We shared the hotel and everything. It was a good time. We did two Patreon episodes together, fully recapping Stardom and Thursday. Friday, we recapped Ring of Honor and TJPW. And then I figured on this podcast, I could recap Saturday, which was WrestleMania and the TJPW GCW show.
Great. Yeah. Let's hear it.
So, as I kick everything, good. I would say Philadelphia as a city, the experience was good because of all the events and everything, and that's a lot of fun, but the city itself is a pain in the ass.
I agree.
It's terrible.
Well, I mean, Boston is too.
Compared it to Boston.
These cities are just super old, and so their streets are designed around things that you can't tear down. So nothing is parallel or perpendicular, and it is just garbage to find your way around.
I wouldn't even say like that was half the battle. Because the way everything was priced and situated was also a pain in the ass. So they have a transportation system in the city.
Oh, well, Philly Mass transit is notoriously terrible.
Yeah, it's like you have a subway here, but it only goes like X amount of blocks.
Right.
You have a train here, but it's like torn up most places in the city.
Right.
And then you have a bus system, and each thing kind of needs its own transit card, which
Wait, there's not like one universal card that you can use, like bus, subway,
So
light rail,
there is
whatever.
one, but it's kind of in that same situation as Toronto, where they're always seemingly in a transition between different systems.
Goodness.
So you get one, you might go back next year and they get rid of it.
Oh my
Because in
goodness.
Toronto, they had tokens for a long time, and
Sure. I mean, everybody had tokens at one point.
then they had the Presto card, which was, but then that required technology updates, and people didn't want to do that, and it's a whole mess. But even through things like parking
Yeah.
and trying to find your way around the city, like you would park, and no matter what you do, you end up having to do an Uber or walking blocks on end.
Even for the WrestleMania weekend events, were they so spread out that you couldn't easily get like from one venue to another? Like with like between like the 2300 arena, the GCW arena and the stadium for WrestleMania, like how far
So
apart were those?
in that sense, that was easier for me because I drove. So I had my
Oh,
car,
okay.
and 2300 Arena is by a is by a bunch of brick and mortar stores, so
Okay.
you can just park there and walk over,
Okay.
no problem. The GCW Collective and everything,
Yeah.
that was on the waterfront, which had free parking.
Okay.
All easy, no
Cool.
problem with any of that. But if you want to go anywhere in the city, that's when it becomes a problem.
Gotcha.
So like the biggest thing was, wanted to meet up with a friend, and he goes, "Oh, meet us at this bar." We're going down Broad Street and all these things, and that's when you finally like get to know the city, and you just go, "Oh my God, how would I get anywhere here? This makes no sense." You can just immediately tell when you're there. I look, Houston, Toronto, London, like I've lived and been
Yeah.
to all these places. Even Boston's better than Philadelphia.
Oof. Oof. Not saying something.
Yeah,
Oof.
and Philadelphia is kind of broken down in a lot of like brotherly love.
All
I don't know. I don't know about that.
right, all right.
Okay.
Aside from the transportation issues, let's talk about the experience a little bit.
Yeah, so food wise, I tried my best to have the best hoagie, and I
Okay.
had really good chicken
Where'd you
wings in
go?
them. So at one point I had Angelo's, at one point I had a couple others, and then just random places. But the big one was out actually near the hotel.
Okay.
Was on the last day leaving a place called Steve's, and it actually has like the sliced steak meat and
Oh,
everything
yeah.
and melted cheese, and they go, "You want roasted red peppers on there?" I'm like, "Hell yeah,
Hell
I do."
yeah.
Like immediately upon the first bite I go, every other cheesesteak I had before this was not even close.
Cool.
Yeah, so that was good. And cheesesteak is definitely on par with like pizza, chicken wings, just you can
Yeah.
have it whenever. Good stuff. So I already spoke about Stardom and TJPW over on the Patreon.
Yep.
So go check that out. Red Leaf Retrocast Patreon, same name. The TJPW GCW show, which on paper looked like it was going to be an atrocity, like a horrible show. It really did look
Not
like
fun, but chaotic is
it.
how I looked at the card.
Yeah. But what I will mention, what I said on the Patreon was all of these shows that I went to, the goal was to be an authentic house show, essentially, of what they were
Yeah.
bringing, which I was totally fine with. I liked it. I think they delivered, and then some to an extent. TJPW GCW
Oof.
went the same route.
Agreed. 100% house show feel.
How can we do a GCW show with TJPW wrestlers?
Yeah.
And I thought they delivered in that aspect, and it turned out to be one of the better shows of the weekend I even watched.
I watched that one live. Well, no, yeah, I
Yeah.
watched that one live in real time, from home. And I had so much fun. So I watched as many WrestleMania weekend shows live in real time as I could. Obviously life happened and I couldn't get to everything, but this one I watched live in real time, and yeah, it felt fun. It felt like you could that venue was, I think, really cool. So tell me a little bit about that venue. What was it called? What type of place was it?
So it was at Penn's Landing, wacky, like, waved steel ceilings.
Okay.
Which kind of threw me off. And the rest of it kind of reminded me of the White Eagle.
Yeah, it felt very much like some, like the White Eagle, like the Ukrainian Center in LA where they sometimes play, like this, like, very, like, storied but cheap.
Yeah, I mean, it had auditorium. Your it had your auditorium with the theater raised stage. And, yeah, you get the idea. An indie venue.
Yeah.
And I mentioned this on my Stardom review with Grizz that the 2300 Arena is the level up. You're sure. Not an indie if you run there.
Yeah.
That's why I came to the conclusion. That's why not a lot of shows ran there. There's only like three shows that ran at 2300 Arena.
But TGPW and Stardom had ran there previously.
In 2019.
Is that how long ago it was? Wow.
Yeah.
Huh. Okay. Anyway, yeah. So the GCW's versus GCW versus TJPW show. I thought they put a really good job putting that card together. I thought that the matchups were interesting and well balanced.
Excuse me.
And then the main event was, I mean, they put Maki Ito on the GCW side, which I thought was really fun.
Well, I mean, she might as well be a GCW wrestler these days.
Right.
With she spends much more time there than she does in TJPW. No, I thought the teams were well balanced. The TJPW wrestlers that should have gone over did.
Mm-hmm.
The Mizuki alley catch match was shockingly like above par.
Agree.
Because I went in expecting a lot of these matches were going to suck because the wrestlers aren't as good.
Yeah.
And they fought above their weight. And I got to call it like I see it. They overperformed.
I agree. I think...
And it's one of their largest crowds of the year, too.
I think that was a lot to do with it. I think they knew how many eyes were on them in person and also on TV. Like, this show was way more accessible to Western fans than most TJPW shows. So I think the pressure or just the knowledge that more people were watching it, everybody rose to the occasion, and it was super fun.
Yeah. The main event, I thought, was the best match. Yeah. I really enjoyed it. Everything else was very house show, but effective.
Yeah.
Which I massively enjoyed. I didn't go to a single show and regretted that I went there. So that was very nice.
Yeah.
I had my reservations about Ring of Honor, but I still had a good time there. The Temple Arena is, like, super nice.
Way bad.
Yeah. Way better than Dunkin' Donuts Center. So, WrestleMania-wise, after I met up with my buddy JPQ, we do the...
Oh, we do JPQ, some, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Hey, JPQ.
Been friends for years now. We met up downtown. He was very accommodating for the very little bit we got to spend. Circumstances, we didn't get to spend as much time as we wanted, but regardless, we at least got to see. And various ideas came out, and one idea we went with, Grizz and I, was... the mention of Xfinity Live in Philadelphia. So in Philadelphia, they have the Philly Stadium, they have the Link where the Eagles play,
okay,
and then the 76ers and Flyers play in the arena like a block away.
Okay,
it's all in this radius.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll call it the middle of it all is a place called Xfinity Live.
Mm-hmm.
It's a massive sports bar extravaganza thing.
Okay.
It's got restaurants in it. It's got quick food, fast food things in it. It's got huge plasma TVs, the whole shebang. There's even like a, we'll call it a cabaret bar off to the side.
Yeah.
With like hot women dancing and stuff. And can't call it a strip club, but it's kind of. You get the idea.
I get the vibe.
So it's right there. Everyone's kind of drinking in the parking lot, doing the whole pregame thing.
So they're showing WrestleMania at this.
And at Xfinity Live, it's free entry, and you can go there.
Cool.
And to me, it represented, to me, okay, for example, when I lived in Toronto, you can't afford Leaf tickets.
Mm-hmm.
They're like asinine expensive.
Sure.
Much like WrestleMania is now.
Yeah.
They're so expensive. And the ticket you can't afford, you're so far away, you can't see anything, all these things. So what a lot of people do go to the huge sports bar across from where the Leafs play,
yep,
called Real Sports Bar. Huge plasma TVs. You can reserve seats and service if you want, etc. It's same deal. Cool. Little nicer, but Xfinity Live has the Philly experience and a stadium experience in this place.
Cool.
I had a great time. Sat at a bar, stood at a bar, could see the huge TV. If I didn't want to like try to see over people or in a circumstance, I could look over and see a smaller TV in much more clarity, and all wrestling fans were there.
Fun.
So got the same experience I did at a stadium,
yeah,
but with paying no ticket prices, and I could literally look to my right and go, hey, I want a beer.
Yeah, and not stand in a 90-minute line for the bathroom and miss 7 matches.
None of that.
And
I went to the bathroom like 7 times because, yeah, I was chugging water and drink. Anyways.
No, I can totally picture that experience. There's something similar in Denver.
I think I have a... I think I took a picture inside. Let's see, right, if I can pull that up.
You can share me a photo. No, there's a very similar experience in Denver.
Take a picture inside. Instead, I took a picture of food.
It didn't used to exist, this Denver experience, but it exists now.
Yeah, my whole WrestleMania experience consisted of that is the only picture I took.
Yeah, that's important, though.
Yeah, the crab fries from Chicky Pete's.
Yeah.
Which I had to try.
Across the street from the Rockies, from Coors Field, where the Rockies play, is an area called McGregor Square.
Okay.
Which didn't exist 4 years ago, and it exists now. It sounds very much like what you described. There's a Tom's Watch Bar there, and they do WrestleMania watch parties.
Is this all in one?
It's all thing? On one block.
Okay, it's a block with a bunch of different places.
Because
Houston built something like that when they built, at the time, Enron, and then when they built the soccer stadium, they bought up land and then created.
So the Monforts own it.
Yeah.
Which,
by the way, Salt Lake is getting a hockey team.
I know.
Yes.
Woo! Bye, Coyotes. See ya.
I can't.
And I know
I'm
you're a
excited.
Utah guy.
Yeah,
know,
I'm a Utah guy, so it's like I'm still gonna root for the Avs, but now I got.
But yeah,
this team.
So McGregor Square, though, it has like all these restaurants and stuff outside. Tom's Watch Bar is the biggest one. And there's a couple other little ones. They're all owned by the Monforts, though. So I feel like they're all...
Probably.
All connected. But in the center is basically like an amphitheater. There's tables on the bottom. But then there's like a grassy space. And
Yeah. And
you can,
I get what you're saying.
Like a grassy hill.
No, this was all inside one building.
I hear you, but let me tell you what this is.
Okay.
So there's like a grassy hill. And there's like a giant, like it's, the screen has got to be at least 12 feet.
I think Dallas has that too in St. Louis. They have those things.
Yeah.
I think they do.
So part of the reason why I am a little bit behind on WrestleMania weekend stuff is the Friday of WrestleMania weekend was also the day of the Rockies home opener.
Which, terrible team, by the way.
Oh, the team is terrible, but going to Rockies opening day is like Christmas and New Year's and St. Patrick's Day and whatever all rolled into one. It's a holiday in Denver. It is one of the biggest drinking days in Denver. And I had no plans to go. It was a work day. But my boss actually.
Here you go. Here's tickets.
Yeah. And so I was like, okay, bye. So we went to the game. The seats were really nice, but it was actually really warm that day, and our seats were directly in the sun. So we left, and we finished the game. We had some friends that were hanging out at McGregor Square, and we finished the game there, which was almost more fun. The drinks were cheaper, and there were still plenty of fans.
That's the other thing.
Standing around.
So I thought the drinks were expensive at Xfinity Live.
Right.
Okay. I mean, I got tall beers.
Yeah.
Apparently, they were twice that in the link.
Oh, my God.
Like, at Mania. Yeah. And I'm like, I can't imagine. Like, I turned down a beer at at a Leafs game because they were going to charge me $20 for a Molson Canadian.
Right.
And I went, fuck you, I'm paying $20 for a Molson Canadian. And this was 5 years ago.
So, anyway.
So, watched WrestleMania. That was night one.
Mm-hmm.
I went, I came back, I drove back here and caught some of night two. And let me tell you, night one, snooze fest.
Oh, it was so slow.
It was so slow, bad. I liked the Becky Lynch Rhea Ripley match.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, look at that. Oh, that's way nicer.
Well, those are generated photos. I'm looking for real ones.
Okay. The... Yeah, so I thought the Ripley Lynch match structurally was, like, identical to what Sheeta and Athena put on at Ring
of
Honor.
But not as good.
I put it, yeah, I put it a step below. Still massively enjoyed it. And then, like, the rest of the show, I thought was pretty bad.
Night one, yeah.
Yeah. Like, we had DIY coming out with so much
and
fucking...
their DX stuff.
Fucking
and...
nerd dorks.
Yeah.
Like, I couldn't... Like, so much Triple H on the show.
Who?
Unbelievably amount of annoying.
Needs
he comes to... out first, he sniffs the air, he's like, oh, I've created this, you know, I've given this to you. Yeah, yeah, nonsense. And then the main event...
Nonsense.
The main event was 45 minutes, and WWE fans, and, like... With the Xfinity Live experience, I could tell, like, how the crowd would react to everything. They loved the entrances. They played along with the yeets.
Yeah.
You know, to that atrocious Uso match.
Oh, my God. It was so bad.
That, like, that was terrible.
I had high hopes for that match,
The Dalton
too.
Castle Johnny TV match was horrible.
Which also I had high hopes for.
Ah.
Well... It's terrible when you sell off the selling point of the match.
And then I thought the main event was incredibly boring.
We're back to WrestleMania. Yeah, the tag match. So the thing about WrestleMania is no one's there for the wrestling. You've spent all year telling your fan base that the important things are the entrances and the pageantry. So when you give them, not saying that there was good wrestling on night one, but when you give them good wrestling, they don't care anyway.
Look, we're rewatching WCW. Well, you're watching. I'm rewatching, unfortunately.
Yeah. I'm watching for the first time.
And that's what that is. When you finally give the crowd wrestling, they don't give a shit.
Yep.
Because they think it's going to be
ruined.
You've
been trained.
You've now been trained. It's, what do they call that? Pavlov's dog with the,
Pavlovian
response. No, well, that's like clapping like a seal stuff, but.
But.
Anyways.
So night two.
And then night two, Io Sky Bailey, I mean, it was a better show bell to bell for sure. And the crowd was into it certainly more because.
Well, the anticipation of Cody.
The anticipation of that. And as for Io Sky Bailey, women's match.
That was pretty good.
I thought it was pretty good. I didn't think it was on par. A lot of people disagree, apparently, according to, like, Cage Match and stuff. But I didn't think Bayley looked particularly good. But Io Shirai was on her kind of main event level.
Yeah.
And did a lot of her P's and Q's, mm-hmm. if you will, to make it a good match, which I appreciated. I'm like 3.5 on it, which is a good match. It's not going to, like, blow me away or I'll remember it, like, down the line. But
yeah.
You know, I thought women's wrestling had a pretty strong WrestleMania week.
The Gunther versus Sammy match was good.
I'll tell you why I didn't like that.
What? Why?
So.
Why?
I was liking it, but Sami Zayn's doing this thing where he starts, like, flopping like a fish.
Have you seen Sami Zayn wrestle?
Well, yeah, but he's not to this extent.
Okay. Go on.
So Gunther is Walter's beating the hell out of him.
Yeah.
And it goes into a WWE formula where you have to really beat him down. You have to constantly look at the family and all this. And it's just a constant retread of the same thing. And it overstays its welcome in my mind and how I
Okay.
Do the match, and he's clearly got the guy beat, and it goes into the typical heel fashion of, oh, I don't want to pin him. Well, why? That's dumb. Now you're being, yeah. So he keeps going to the top, and then Sammy then, like, you hear it in the background. He's flopping like a fish. He's pounding the mat. He's flailing his arms. And I'm like, oh, my God. And Walter's looking at him like, the fuck's wrong with this guy? He looks like a crazy guy. He's insane. Now, I did really pop for the top rope brainbuster deal.
Yeah.
So he hasn't busted that out.
He hadn't been allowed to.
Right.
Vince had banned it.
Well. So that was a great way to end the match. He pulled out the
match killer. Hadn't used in 10 plus years. Yes.
So maybe it's probably not right that I say I didn't like the match. I didn't like it as much as other people.
That's fair.
Because of these certain aspects. That's fair. It took me out of it. As for Cody Roman, going to night two to end it. Not a match for me. It's
so overbooked.
It's so over ridiculous. And I don't think that was the right way to end the Cody story. And I was talking to a couple of my friends and even people at work that
I would have liked to see him do it on his own.
Exactly. That's been the same opinion through all the WWE fans that I work with, that I know, where they go, why was this not about Cody? And why, by the end of it, everyone thought it was more about The Rock, The Undertaker, John Cena, and that's it.
Yep.
Cody was an afterthought. Okay, he won the title. Great. But that wasn't the point.
He should have overcome more obstacles.
Right.
Like, he had already overcome so much.
Now, he's only finished the story because the legends let him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I agree. If they had come out and been extra obstacles that he had overcome.
Yeah.
That would be something.
And so many things are so far removed from another. I personally don't think even the John Cena solo Sokoa thing is even part of the story.
I don't think so either.
Because John Cena's been gone for so long, and then he just happens to show up for this one time.
Right.
You know, and clotheslines out. Anyways, whatever. I didn't like the match. WWE fans loved it because they liked the ending.
Yeah.
Which, Xfinity Live, upon each, like, good guy winning the match, they blew off a huge smoke machine.
Fun.
Poof. It was wild.
Fun.
It was like a train going off.
Fun. Excuse me. Sorry.
So that was WrestleMania week. As for AEW, we got a lot to talk about.
We do have a lot to talk about, actually.
So I played Jack Perry's music, so let's just go right into it.
Yeah. So I suggested Jack Perry's music because of this week's Dynamite.
The combination of WrestleMania week with CM Punk there.
Yep.
AEW and showing the All-In footage. And then New Japan doing Sakura Genesis and Windy City Riot. Jack Perry kind of comes full circle to all three companies right now.
So when AEW first dropped the tease about, we will show never before seen backstage footage from All In, and the internet went into a tizzy, I didn't watch any of that live. And then I finally watched the episode where they teased it, and I was like, they never said it would be anything about Punk and Perry. It could be nothing. It could be Okada trying on Nick Jackson's fucking gear. Like, it could be, you know. But then all of the outlets said, like, Fightful said it was going to be what we think it is.
Yeah.
But I still didn't.
All of this is based on the Hawani interview with Punk.
Well.
And Punk buried things, annoyed people again. And Hawani, with other people coming on his show, he was trying to get them to bury the company of AEW as well. And he tried to get Cody to do it. He tried to get Barnett to do it.
I guess.
And they weren't about that. So I could see this. I could see the ploy where Tony Khan or the Bucks or whomever, this was a Tony Khan idea, supposedly, where enough is enough. Let's make an angle about it. and let's clear the air.
Yeah.
The problem is,
it's been 8 months. Who cares?
It's been X amount of time, and I could only see a scenario where it would backfire. Because what we saw in the video described what CM Punk more or less said in the interview. He embellished certain things because it's his side.
He also said he didn't throw a punch.
Which he kind of did. Like, he shoved him through, and then he grabbed Perry, choked him, and then immediately got pulled off, knocked monitors over at Khan, and went at him. So it's like, all of the things that were said what happened...
Happened,
and were true. So, it was a strange reaction, not unexpected on social media and various other platforms where they go, well, Punk told the truth. This makes AEW look bad. I go, but Punk's a psycho, and he said he was a psycho in the interview. And people aren't rationally seeing it that way.
It's not just what Punk said. It's people rationalizing his actions. It's people saying, well, he was provoked.
Well, he wasn't, though. That was the thing.
No matter what...
But, yeah.
No matter what Jack Perry said, even if Jack Perry said, I'm going to go to your mom's house and fuck her and then murder her and then...
Oh, God, we really
shit on her
that.
Grave. Like, it doesn't matter what he said. If you are a normal human, you don't... You don't react physically.
Yeah.
And then all of the internet nerds going like, are you saying if somebody disrespected your mom, you wouldn't stand up and you wouldn't do? No. Okay. No. Because what imagine if instead of the reaction of sorry, excuse me.
Okay. Here, this happens at my place of work more often than it should. People get in arguments.
Yeah.
And it's like fucking high school. Oh, I'm going to fight you. You disrespected me. Let's meet in the parking lot after school. It's the same shit. People get into fights off campus, if you will.
Sure.
Out of the workplace because they know if they fucking attack someone
in
the workplace, they're going to get fired, get arrested, all these things.
I mean, yes, but also the fact that, like, literally...
If a fucking 10-year-old can figure this out where they go, oh my god, if I fight someone in the classroom, I'm in trouble. I will see you in... I will see you at the flagpole. Then why can't CM Punk do that after Wembley? But no, he's a fucking unhinged maniac. And he just goes, oh, you told me to fuck your mom, or I'm gonna... Whatever scenario that you said.
Whatever it is.
Yeah, and his first reaction is... I'm going to choke him.
Again,
which is assault.
Again, it doesn't matter what was said, because if being verbally provoked was a defense,
it's never a defense.
If it was, what if he had pulled out a gun and shot him? Are you going to justify a verbal provocation? You know,
this like, is this why is, assault is illegal.
Yeah, this is what I'm saying. Like, it's just so...
In the 1800s, we had duels.
Anyone defending...
Right?
You'd, anyone...
You have insulted my honor.
My honor!
White glove! Yeah. Okay, let's draw up a contract that if someone dies, no one's held the con about.
It is like, just... there are no words. There are no words that could have been said that would justify any sort of physical retribution.
Oh, and then someone actually posted this on Twitter where they showed Punk coming out for his match in the tunnel, mm-hmm. and he has this smirk on his face where he knows he just got what he wanted.
Yeah.
To leave the company. I think he did it on... I hope I said this, because I believe it previously, where he did all this on purpose as designed to get himself fired from the company. Because he was just so fed up with...
With what, though? They gave him his own fucking show!
All kinds of things. He's not a rational human being.
True. Whatever.
Yeah.
I don't... Ugh, it's unfortunate.
And the unfortunate thing is we're spending 10, 15 minutes on this subject instead of talking about
Fun stuff.
the fun stuff, which is the wrestling. I thought Dustin and Samoa Joe had a good match.
Oh, they
I thought
did.
Edge and Penta had a good match.
Yeah. Though, okay, here's my problem with that episode of Dynamite, though. Okay, so as the listeners probably have figured out by now that I'm on the East Coast, but I've been staying with my parents. And so I watched this episode of Dynamite in front of my parents,
Oh
which is a problem because, as I think most of you know, I wasn't raised in wrestling. I didn't watch it as a kid. My parents have never watched it.
no.
They understand that it's something that I enjoy. They
Okay.
understand why I enjoy it too. They're not the, oh, don't you know it's fake people at all. They understand that it's about the stories,
You know, my mom
and
was on this podcast for like a year, right?
I know. But
Hated Cody.
so my parents are very like understanding, and they want to understand why
Oh,
I
that reminded
watch.
me. My mom called me up
Yeah.
the next day after WrestleMania
Yeah.
because at work they were talking about like Cody
Oh,
winning,
okay. And what'd she
and
say?
they asked her, and she goes, "That piece of shit won the title." Died. Her
That's
hatred of him
amazing.
still lives.
Vindication.
She goes, "Who'd put a title on that guy? You see what's on his neck?"
Oh my God.
So your parents are
So
watching
anyway, so anyway,
it. I forgot to mention that. So
so anyway, I turned on this episode of Dynamite, and I already knew before the episode started, I already knew it was unfortunate that this was going to be their first Dynamite episode because it was just going to be the
Oh, I
build-up
see.
to the Punk
Yeah, and they have no
video,
context to
and they
any
have
of it.
no context for it. And
Oh, I thought about that. So in their minds, they probably think that's also fake.
oh yeah, they 100% did.
Yeah.
100%. And I didn't even like, I was like too exhausted. I was like, I can't even tell you why this is important or why it's real.
Which begs the question, were they interested?
Well,
Because they're showing the
I
grainy
don't
footage and
know. And so my mom was sitting there and she was crocheting the whole time. So she was kind of only half paying attention. And my dad was in and out of the room. Here's the AEW-WCW comparison
comparison,
again. My dad, after the first hour of television, he's finally back in, and he's been kind of paying attention, even
yeah.
though he's been in and out. He goes, okay, so they talk a lot, and then there's like a little bit of wrestling, and then there's 20 minutes of commercials. And I was like, oh my God. And I was like trying to be like, no, Dad, this episode is not
It's not normal.
typical of this company.
I'm glad your dad says that
He
because
noticed.
that's why my parents don't watch wrestling
Yeah.
anymore and why they occasionally watch AEW still.
And
But they watch it because there's more action.
yeah.
They hate the talking.
I don't know that from my dad it was necessarily a critique because he hasn't watched wrestling ever. This was just an
Yeah.
observation. He was literally just trying to understand the I think he was trying to put together the formula of the show.
Yeah.
And I was like, this is not typical AEW.
This is not their formula. Yeah.
Yeah. But he caught it. So, I mean, he's a bright guy.
Yeah.
But anyway.
I mean, that's why I mostly fell out of the mainstream wrestling
Yeah.
is because they got away from the action and it was
Right.
just the Triple H era is really what stands
Oh my
out to me
goodness.
in the
Yep.
early 2000s. Fucking 20 to 40 minutes of talking. And then when they wrestle, it's 40-minute matches of bore
Oh
fests
my goodness.
and interference and DQs. And as we can see from what we saw in WrestleMania,
What are we seeing? Long-ass promos.
Yep.
And long-ass dull matches.
Yep.
Yeah. That's the future of WWE. So back to AEW. I still think they've had strong weeks, besides last week being the people... people have been using the term wet fart, which I think is kind of accurate. I think that's fair. But the weeks prior, minus Toni Storm, very strong.
Yeah.
What'd you think of Mina sharing champagne and kissing Mariah May? Oh my goodness. May?
Okay, so
she looks great, by the way, right?
She looks amazing. Somehow in the moment I missed the kiss.
What if I get those shorts with the chains?
I think that'll look hot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely. Specifically,
you can pull it off.
Specifically for bowling, right? Come on, you can see the form going.
Yeah.
Maki Ito remembered me, by the way.
No way!
She caught me, and I forgot to mention this, but she caught me and she goes, "You're the bowling guy, 300. And I went,
"What?
No way.
Wait, really?
Yeah.
No way.
It was off onto the side before she got to her, like, autograph table.
So, like, from your tweet?
I was wearing the Maki Ito thing, and she recognized me.
Wow. And I'm like, oh, that's so sweet.
Yeah, that was wild. I got to speak to Aja Kong.
Wild.
Which was kind of cool. She speaks no English, so you know how that went.
Still no English.
No.
Nothing.
No. She's had no reason to learn English.
Yeah, but, like, I would have thought. Yeah. Maybe at this point she'd take something up.
Yeah. And so... getting autographs and everything in WrestleMania weekend was a challenge. And you had to have a lot of cash.
Sure.
You had to have a lot of cash and a lot of patience. So Stardom wrestlers, you can only see them at, like, Access and things.
Uh-huh.
And the way Joshi wrestlers operate when they come to America, and it might be the same in Japan.
Cash only.
It's cash only.
Yep.
They did have a PayPal-type option. But it's you pay... $30 just to see them.
Yep.
And then most of the times they'll have, like, the package where, okay, it's $30, I will give you a picture and an autograph, and then we're done here.
Yeah. Or if you buy a shirt, then you get a photo, or if
I mean, that part's kind of seems to be kind of normal indie type stuff, but you essentially have to pick and choose.
Sure.
And you can only get, like, one.
Yeah.
Because they're only going to be there so long. So I let my friends kind of do that. And I went over the people that didn't have the reservation type stuff.
Yeah.
Where you had to do. But, yeah, that was tough. That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
To go through. And I was like, I don't got that kind of cash.
Get it.
Yeah.
I get it.
But, I got one.
What did you get?
I was managed to get one. Saki. All caps Saki.
Oh.
Yeah. I got that kind of at a, I was like, if I don't get it, I'll regret it. I gotta get someone.
Yeah.
It was kind of that mentality.
Yeah.
So I was like, do that.
That's great.
But yeah, Stardom is in AEW, it seems.
Oh, it seems here to stay, for sure.
Yeah, and,
I mean, Azumi has a match.
Azumi has a match with Timeless Tony. I'm not crazy about Timeless Tony being the main connection to start. I mean, she's a former Stardom champion and all that. Like, I get that part, but...
if it was regular Tony, I would be way
more... I'd be way more into it, yeah. The Timeless gimmick, not so much. The part that I think a lot of AEW and even Joshi fans are missing is because there's been a PR... hit perception going on between getting Rossy Ogawa out of the picture.
Sure.
And none of it is on the actual dude who got let go from the position.
Yeah.
So, O'Hara, I think that was his name. We'll go with it. It's late. He was the guy that came up with the schedule and not in communication and not allowing wrestlers to... go XYZ places. It was all him for the most part.
Okay.
Ogawa's never been crazy about working with AEW. That's not a secret. Right. He's more of a WWE guy. But he's very much in protecting his wrestlers and protecting his assets. Because he's a firm believer that once you show them someplace higher than his, he'll lose them sooner and not, like, continue to have them make money for his company.
Mm-hmm.
Smart businesses start, but he's never been opposed to them leaving. That's the other thing. Okay. Io Shirai went to WWE.
Sure.
Kyrie went to WWE. He's lost his two biggest stars. He's had to fire people before. So as soon as the president got fired and all of the issues went down, Ogawa left and he started his own company. The schedules have also rapidly changed with this new guy, Taro Okada, in charge.
Okay.
And now we're seeing one of his firm beliefs in changing the company is to get the wrestlers out to places in stardom. So the schedule hasn't changed. Not really for how much they work, but now they're working abroad and in other companies. So we got wrestlers going to show up in Wave, Diana, Ring of Honor, AEW. He thinks his objective is to expand the wrestlers rather than the company.
Okay.
Thinking that the wrestlers will draw people to the company. While the other guy, his idea was run as much as you can domestically and get more people domestically to your shows. Internationally will happen in time.
I see both views.
I see the domestic view as a stronger case than the international one personally, because I think the international ones will be there regardless as long as you put on a good product.
Probably.
Because they can't go anyways.
Right.
Right? So we'll see what happens with Stardom going forward and Forbidden Door. That's going to be an option. Sure. Looks like Mina Shirakawa is firmly in line for something involving Toni Storm.
Oh, yeah. Fucking Winnie Cedarette.
Yes. So New Japan. Sakura Genesis. I thought the show was pretty bad.
Yeah.
Skip everything, including the main event. I wasn't crazy about Naito Yoda Tsuji.
That's too bad.
I thought it was kind of boring. Kind of felt like you knew who was going to win the whole time.
So I didn't watch any of Sakura Genesis, and I haven't watched Winnie City Riot yet, because as we sit here and record, today is Saturday. It's Saturday night. The show was just last night.
No, Sakura was last week. Windy City was last night.
Sorry. I'm here on the East Coast. I'm doing family stuff, so I'm just behind. But coming out of Windy City Riot, there were a lot of talking points, so I was hoping that the match quality was good.
Yeah, let me pull up the card.
But also coming out of Sakura Genesis, I would have thought that... Do you think... Because Yoda Tsuji, man, they want him to be something. Is he still something?
Yeah. I mean, there's no doubt he's a guy.
Okay.
Crowd likes him. He's putting on good matches. There just needs to be that extra kick.
Okay.
To get him to the final level.
And they're
building that.
Okay.
I think he is the... Shota Umino, he's almost to Yoda Tsuji.
Do you still believe in these guys, Shota and Yoda Tsuji, and the other guy from Noah?
Oh, Kiyomiya? No, yeah. He's done. Forget him.
Okay.
He's a dork. Narita, I think, as long as he's shackled by this House of Torture thing and he can't figure out something other than that,
okay,
he's yesterday's news until further notice. Umino... After watching Windy City Riot and what they're building to with him and Moxley.
Yeah.
And...
Because he's going to be Moxley's first challenger, right?
No. It's Ren Narita.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
More
House of Torture.
Hang on. We'll dive in. Yeah. We'll maybe do that in order.
But Yoda Tsuji's a guy. Like, he's going to be champion.
Okay.
It's a matter of time. And he's over now. But he's still missing... taking that last step to get to, like, a superstar level.
Okay.
So he's there.
So how did Windy City Riot go? There were so many talking points coming out of it.
Yeah. So we got Tom Lawler's group splitting up with...
Right.
TMDK won.
Oh, by the way, speaking of Tom Lawler's group, okay, so the next Lucha Libre and Laughs show is going to be another two-night show for their anniversary in June. So last year they did two nights because it was the promotion's 10-year anniversary.
Yep.
This year they're doing two nights because it's Royce Isaacs' 10-year wrestling anniversary. So Royce Isaacs booked night two of this show. Tom Lawler and Royce Isaacs and Jarrell Nelson. Okay. Is it Jarrell Nelson? Jarrell, whatever his last name is, from Team Filthy.
Yep.
Are booked on this show.
They might have some angle or...
There's definitely an angle. That'll be a good show to go to. Alex Shelley is also booked on that show. I mean, like literally...
The Motor City Machine Guns are free agents.
They are free agents. I don't know if Chris Haven at this point is not booked. That doesn't mean he's not showing up, but... I'm so excited, and the promoter from Lucha Libre let me know, just kind of like, he was like, because Double or Nothing is the day after. So there's two nights of Lucha Libre and Laughs on a Friday and a Saturday, okay. And Double or Nothing is the Sunday following. And he messaged me, and he was, when I said to him about how good the card looked, and he goes, yeah, it would have looked a whole lot better if Double or Nothing was not the next night. I had a whole lot more planned.
Yeah. So let's see here. Ren Narita got a victory over Suzuki. So that goes into why he's challenging. He got a strong win.
Great.
The Vacker Azumi match.
Yes.
Very strong. Like I said, it's been a good 2 weeks in women's wrestling for strong performances. The match was short. It was only 11 minutes, but it was a strong match.
I believe it, with the talent that was involved.
Pun intended. So I liked how I pulled that off.
Get it.
Umino Jack Perry was that was my favorite match on the show.
Really?
Yeah. Fantastic. I really liked that. Yeah.
And I love hearing that.
I was actually shocked Perry lost, because he came out, he has a broken glass tights
type deal. Right, and his jacket said Crimea River.
Crimea River scapegoat kind of deal. He's got this, roadkill aspect to him.
Yeah.
Comes out with SWAT team members, he's got needs protected.
Well, because he's in Chicago.
Yeah. I liked all that. He's getting mixed signals, but I think he's gonna be a babyface.
I hope
they're gonna book him in the Bucks like heels. But they're gonna be babyfaces because of the whole punk thing.
Yeah, I like that.
So they're gonna have to do a they let the crowd cheer. Who cares?
Agree.
Yeah, they want to be douchebags and you cheer them.
Everybody loves cheering for heels anyway.
Yeah, these would be cases where, as long as you match them up properly, and you don't bury a baby face, a pure baby face,
right?
Then I think this will work. Ali Hiromu. Ugh. I did get a kick out of Hiromu coming out with Daryl, but now he's jacked.
Buff!
He's buff Daryl! Yeah. But comedy match, I kind of want to see him go more.
I would love to see Ali do more. I'll
put it this way. If Ali is in Boss J, which I think they announced.
Did they? Thank God.
You know, not the time and place.
Did they announce Boss J? Because I have other people that I want in there. But anyway, continue.
Oh, here we go. I got it. Boss J 31 lineup. This is good, because we're talking about it
now. Oh, good, because I had ideas.
Sho, Hiromu, Taguchi, Despy, Kevin Knight. Well, Yo's not in anymore. He got injured 10 seconds into his match.
Great, okay.
So he's done. Bushi, Titan, TJP, Dookie, Robbie Eagles is back.
Okay.
Connors. Who's this? Oh, Maloney. This is funny. Blake Christian, All Heart.
Yeah.
They have All Heat on the New Japan site.
Brilliant. I love, he's a heel.
That's funny.
So I love it.
Ninja Mac is in Best of the
Super Bowl. Yeah! That's
okay. So no Mustafa Ali on Best.
Okay, wait. Is that everyone?
That was everyone.
Oh, I had other thoughts. I was hoping for Anthony Henry, too.
No. Well, he's injured, too, right now.
Oh, yeah. When does Boston start?
Like, I think it's, like, next week, isn't it?
Okay. Then, yeah, he couldn't have made it.
Yeah, I'm kind of disappointed because if Ali and Hiromu were going to have that match,
yeah,
and Ali was going to be in Boss J, or there were like imminent plans,
yeah,
for him and Hiromu to have a follow-up or something involving the junior title, I would have been okay with the match, but they're not.
Yeah.
So I was disappointed that they didn't go as hard. And Ali's kind of been working this way a lot lately.
Okay.
Windy City Riot card. Got to pull that back up.
Oh, we were like halfway through it.
No, let's see. Bullet Club match. Nothing right to say there.
Oh, TMDK.
We already mentioned that.
We did?
Yeah. Zack Sabre Jr. beat Matt Riddle. So Riddle.
Yeah, fuck Riddle. Fucking, I don't care.
There's rumors that he's already like burned his bridge with the company.
Good. Fuck him.
Which amuses me.
No, I don't have any patience for terrible people.
But I was like. This TV title's, like, fine.
Yeah.
But I want to see Zach go for the main one.
Yeah.
They clearly have other plans, though.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Tomorrow night is the Prestige Roseland 8 show. DSJ versus Daniel Maccabee.
That'll be a grapple fuck match.
Mustafa Ali versus Kevin Blackwood.
Well, with the way Ali's wrestling lately, I don't know.
I mean, that whole show is bonkers.
For an indie show, it'll be good, though. Yeah.
Oh, I mean, it is the most ridiculous indie card I've ever seen.
Nick Nemeth beat Ishii, yep, in a non-title match. Not sure.
Wait, why was the title not on the line?
I don't know.
Okay.
New Japan's weird right now.
Agree.
And then Moxley beat Naito.
Yeah.
Which, hey, there was a lot of people that thought Moxley was going to win this match. They thought he should. And I'm definitely torn. I'd prefer Naito would have retained and then, yeah, we could continue his, finally he gets a long run with the title, but Naito's Japanese Dusty Rhodes.
Yeah.
For him, it's the chase. Give him a person he can't beat. Go after him. And in this case now, the story's Moxley.
I really
he's never beat him, and he can't beat him.
I really enjoyed Moxley saying, like, I might only have one shot at this belt. This is my shot.
And he has it, and he's taken time off from AEW to go on tour with New Japan.
Yeah.
More or less.
Yeah.
And defend this title, and he's immediately in a story with Narita, which is a young talent that they want to push. And he's got the built-in story with the Umino. I see a lot of pros to this. Maybe currently is not the best time. And doing it in Chicago, maybe not have been the best time.
Don't know.
Doing a title change in America, certainly. I mean, look, they drew like 6,000 people.
Yeah.
So is it another play to perhaps continue to get these crowds in America?
Yeah, so yes, but then they announced the G1 cities, and there are no American appearances for the G1.
Well, that's the G1. That's not Moxley defending the title that he has.
I know.
And how long is he going to have? I mean, he could lose this in a couple months at Dominion.
He could. I'm just saying, in previous years, there have been at least 2 G1 dates in the States.
Oh.
So, like, no, Dallas and...
No, it's been a while.
Has it been,
yeah,
that long?
Because they couldn't do anything during the pandemic. They haven't, true, been back since 2019.
Since 2019? Was, yeah, that the last time they did G1?
That's 5 years.
Well, then I guess I thought it was time.
So, Windy City Riot, a lot of talking points to come out. We'll be discussing that for weeks.
Yeah.
Moxley's champion, that's...
That is, yeah, that's the biggest thing.
That's the biggest thing. And now it's WCW time.
No.
Yeah, we got to do it.
No.
No, it's a landmark show.
No.
Yeah.
No, I don't want to.
Well, you know, here we go. they have had that theme for over a year and a half now.
Terrible.
It's a terrible theme.
It's so bad. It sounds like feedback.
Yeah. It's all. It's like the bunny ears aren't quite lined up. Yeah, it's awful. What does that age us both?
Yeah, we're old. Anyway,
So we're heading towards Spring Stampede.
Shut up.
The go home show. Okay.
Shut up.
We left off. Sid Vicious and company. You know, title. The whole show was building up. Vince Russo's coming back into power, and he's working with Eric Bischoff. How will they coexist?
How will they coexist? Also,
they're going to fight each other as soon as they have to interact.
Also, we skipped, technically we skipped an episode. That was a recap episode.
Recap.
I'm just telling the listeners because...
No, that turns out to be important.
Because it turns out to be important.
Yeah.
Why does it turn out to be important?
Okay. So Ready the Rumble, the movie premiere, was the week of the recap episode.
Correct.
So all the stars that were in the movie were at the premiere. Sting, DDP especially, Sid Vicious, you get the idea.
So instead of airing a new episode of WCW the week before, the week we're talking about, they did a recap episode, which is why JD and I talked about movie last week. There was nothing new in WCW to talk about.
Turns out that was a good choice.
It was a good choice, except for...
We got good feedback on our Ready to Rumble.
Right? Oh, really? Yeah, I need to hear about it.
Yeah.
All right. So, there's this, like, 9 hour long promo to open this episode of Nitro.
It was 20 minutes.
9 hours.
9 hours. Who would have guessed? So let's see here. Oh, no, I haven't pulled up on my computer here. As I move in. Here we go. Okay. So, unprecedented episode of Nitro. Only 5 wrestling matches.
Only 5?
Yeah, only 5. None of them over, what, 5 minutes?
They're never over 5 minutes.
All right, the Sting-Sid Vicious match was 6 minutes, but whatever.
What? Oh, my God, I'm dying. Okay, let's go through it.
So... It's the big moment. It is the reset of WCW. Russo and Bischoff are here. They're going to take this company to new heights.
The entire roster, except for...
The stars.
The quote-unquote old stars.
Yeah.
The entire roster is in the ring and around the ring.
Yeah. So Jeff Jarrett cuts a promo. And it's important to note that it's the most important people to note are Jeff Jarrett, Booker T, Scott Steiner comes down, Vampiro, Billy Kidman.
Yep.
You get the idea.
They're all in the ring.
These guys are in the ring. And Jeff Jarrett cuts a promo and he introduces Vince Russo. He comes out and he looks like a stereotypical New Yorker from 1999.
Because he is a stereotypical New Yorker from 1999.
Yeah, he exactly is. And
not only does he look like one, so half the roster are in gear, half of them are like in like business attire, and almost everybody is like looking like they're trying to present their best selves. And Vince Russo comes down wearing a shirt that's 7 sizes too big. And no tie, and I can't even describe. It is a very late 90s, early 2000s look, but it is not. He's never been seen on TV before as a character. This is not how I would want to present myself.
No. And commentary is constantly telling us, oh my God, Vince Russo's never been on TV, even though... Supposedly, we know it's him. That's the powers that be.
Right.
And, like, we've heard his voice, and we see his hands in camera shots. So Russo comes out, and he cuts a promo. And if you've ever listened to Russo ever speak in his life, even to this day, he still talks about the political BS.
Yep.
the people at TNT, or yep. as they say, the good old
the
boys.
The good old boys.
Yeah. He was the right-hand man of Vince McMahon. He took to the WWF to new heights.
Yep.
Rinse and repeat the same formula and sayings over and over again by those exact words. And he mentions in his promo the new blood. Basically, everyone in the ring, those five names I mentioned, are kind of the key figures. The new blood this, the new blood that. Get where we're going with this, if you know your WCW history. If not, stay tuned. Bischoff yells, "Are you done yet?" Comes out. He teases he's going to fight the guy. There's some supposed to be tension. And then they embrace. They high five. They shake hands.
Bischoff and Russo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Bischoff goes, "Man, we got a lot in common. We're going to take this company." And Bischoff then buries all the old guys in the back. DDP, Lex Luger, Sting.
Sid Vicious,
and they're watching on a monitor. Noted, Ric Flair and Hulk Hogan, nowhere to be seen.
Oh, good point. Okay. Yeah.
So Bischoff is saying he regrets ever doing anything with those guys. What a mistake. It's all about the new generation, the new blood. All those millionaires in the back, he made them. And in fact, all of those millionaires in their club should come out.
Millionaires.
Millionaires Club. New Blood versus Millionaires Club. We're building it. So, DDP, Vicious, Sting, and Luger all come out on the ramp. Yeah. Bischoff buries them one by one, saying he made them, they'd be nothing without them, blah, blah, blah. Russo then takes the mic and says, "Well, it's a new era, it's even playing field." He's stripping every one of the titles. All the titles are vacant, and we're going to figure all this out at Spring Stampede. So tonight for the world title, we're going to have a tournament. It's like four matches, or five, or however many there were tonight.
It's like, yeah.
And that's how we're going to figure this out. And all throughout the night, it's one match after another, building on the story of the new generation beating up the old guys. So, in a vacuum of seeing this by itself,
mm-hmm.
okay, I actually got to say, it was intriguing, interesting television. Now, was the 20-minute promo kind of stupid and drawn out with a lot of the inside sources that didn't make any sense in 2000?
Right.
In 2024 ears, you go, okay, this is kind of interesting because we would know all this, right? We'd get what they were saying. 2000, we don't know any of that shit.
Right.
So I'm like, okay, I kind of get the idea. I get the reset idea. This company's in shambles. There's no denying it.
Right.
Right? So I understand the concept to reset and start over fresh. All good and well. And you want to build up two factions. New guys, old guys. Right? That's a winning formula too.
Sure.
The problem is, which you see right away, is the fans for so long are tired of the old guys running roughshod
True.
Over the new generation.
The new generation.
They want to see new stars be made. So all throughout the night of WCW, Nitro, is Russo helps out Jarrett.
Yep.
Bischoff turns on Hogan to establish that.
Right.
So they do that, and they have a new blood guy beat up an old guy, and then you saw Douglas fighting Ric Flair. Because Ric Flair comes in later, and Shane Douglas beats up Ric Flair, and they bloody, and they have a brawl. There was a lot of brawls on the show. That's why there was only like five matches. So what they've set up immediately was, instead of, is Sid down here?
Sid's coming.
Oh, hi, Kitty Cat.
Hi, buddy.
Hey, buddy. So you would think Bischoff would be with the old guys, right? And Russo would be with the new guys to kind of establish a voice to the factions. Instead, they set both heel creative guys with the new guys, and now they beat down all the old guys to make them baby faces. They've done it opposite. Completely wrong.
Opposite.
Now, it was funny seeing after Bischoff kind of poke Hogan with the chair.
Oh, my God.
And Hogan bleeds. He scratches himself open. For like 30 minutes of the show, they keep going into the back.
Yeah.
And he's screaming like a wild man. Ah, he's pushing stuff over.
Yeah, because it's a fucking psycho.
It's actually really funny. Because...
It is not funny.
No, no, no. Look. He's busted open. He's pissed off about the turn. Makes sense. He's tipping shit over. He's throwing shit. So then they have like a match, an angle, a promo. Then they cut back. Hogan's still in the back throwing shit around. They do it again. Match, promo, you know, whatever. They cut to the back a third time. He's still throwing. He's busting open doors.
Oh, my God. Goodness gracious.
And then they go back again. Match, promo. And I'm thinking, oh, my God, are they going to do it a fourth time where he's this bloody maniac?
Yeah,
I'm like,
yeah.
He's showing up at press boxes, and he's like, where's Bischoff? And he's all bloody. Really funny. There's like a hot woman with a beer in a press
box. Of
course. Going, like, what is happening? That's Hulk Hogan. Oh, is he gone?
Bison.
Yeah. And so it cuts to Hogan now in a limo, doors open, and the camera's kind of huddling.
Yeah, yeah.
And I kid you not, he says these words. Because Billy Kidman, like, beat him up and pinned him and all this. He says these words. As for Bischoff, I'm going to eat his ass, brother.
No.
Oh, yeah. No. Get this camera out of my face. And I'm like, oh, he meant to say four
kick
other things.
His ass or...
He meant to say, like, four other things, but they all combined. And he said,
I'm going to eat his ass. Great.
I'm going to eat his ass, brother. So funny.
He should be in the Bear Bronson, Bear Boulder with that.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God. So, our ending tournament matches, as we care, because the matches were fucking 4 minutes a pop, basically.
Right, right.
With interference, New Blood guy would interfere, or whatever, and the old guy would lose.
In Denver, Colorado.
Yes. So, DDP beat Total Package. They pitted them against each other.
Fine.
Okay. Sting beat Sid Vicious because the wall chokeslammed Vicious through a table.
So they put all of the old people against each other.
At first. Okay. And then Kurt Hennig wanted something, but they see him as an old guy too.
Sure.
Okay. So Jeff Jarrett beats him via interference. Who cares?
Whatever.
Ric Flair defeats Douglas by disqualification because of Russo and all this bullshit.
Sure.
Okay. And then our main event was DDP defeats Sting because they pitted them against each other, and then there was more interference to various New Blood guys. And Mike Awesome debuted on the show, by the way.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So, thumbs up.
Sure.
Exciting show, I guess. We got Spring Stampede.
I don't know.
We get to see the fallout from this.
Great.
Look, Ricky, the next month of WCW Nitro is legendary.
I know. We were looking ahead to it, and a lot of it is meme-tastic. So, yeah. We'll see.
We'll see. Good episode. We're done here.
Night.